Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2016. Can I remind everybody present that all electronic devices should be switched off at all times? Our first item is to take evidence on college reforms, focusing on their impact on learners and employers in particular. Can I welcome Annette Bruton? Annette Bruton, Edinburgh College, Paul Little, City of Glasgow College, Barry McCulloch, Federation of Small Business, and Gordon McGuinness, Skills Development Scotland. Good morning and welcome to all of you. Before I move into questions from the rest of the committee, can I start by asking each of you, before we get into the specific areas of questioning, to give a very short overall view of the benefits that you would have expected would have resulted from the college reform, and whether in fact you think they have been delivered. Gordon.
Thanks very much. I can probably view it from two sides. Chair, I was a board member and chair of Reed Care College in Paisley through to its merger into West College Scotland. And then obviously my role at SDS in terms of the work we've done, particularly with sectoral development. So I think for us, if I reflected back to when we started working in the energy sector, we're having a meeting with the colleges in the renewable sector, and we had 41 of the 43 colleges at that time in the room. It was very difficult to then have a kind of strategic conversation with them and develop the sector in that way in terms of how they responded to industry. So from my point of view, the regionalisation agenda with colleges of bigger scale, the ability of expertise and investment, I think has been a positive development, and one I see only developing further as we get stronger work with industry and in the sectors. In terms of individuals, then I think there's a danger you conflate the issues around regionalisation with the budgetary pressures that we've faced across the public sector. I spend a fair amount of time talking to students in the colleges and across colleges. I'm now on the board of Clyde College in Glasgow. And the student experience, I think, is strong. I don't have any statistical evidence or any feel for comparing it before and after regionalisation, but certainly the experiences I have are really positive. I was at Ferguson Marine Engineering in Port Glasgow last Friday, and their 15 apprentices were undertaking their studies at Clyde College, the Clyde Bank campus, and again a really, really positive experience, not just from the students but also from their supervisors and instructors. So I think college mergers, there's big cultural change to detect that, and that takes a good number of years to work through the system. I don't think we're quite through there yet, but from our perspective, and certainly Skills Development Scotland, the regionalisation programme has been a good step forward.
Thank you. Barry?
Yeah. From the small business perspective, the benefits that we would expect would be twofold: increased responsiveness to the labour market and enhanced employer engagement. And I think if we're being honest, there's still some way to go. It is early. I think we should stress that and not make too many firm conclusions. But the evidence that we have suggests that in the last 2 years, college leavers are slightly more prepared for work. So there are some early signs that are quite positive.
Okay, thank you. Paul.
Mr Chairman, I think the last time I was here I talked about the three R's, the regionalisation reform and reclassification. I actually have been reflecting since. I think we, as a sector, face six R's as a sector and indeed three R's as colleges. Rationalisation of the budgets and a number of colleges, regionalisation, reclassification, a revamped funding formula, a reintroduction of national marketing and a refocused curriculum. And at the same time, internally in colleges, the staff faced restructuring and realignment of cultures. And at the City of Glasgow College, we had an additional one. We had the redefinition of college education. Now, I'm sure some would have felt it was a deluge of reforms. However, I believe, and we're probably unique in that we're 6 years in our sixth year past the merger now and after the reform, having trailblazed a lot of it. I believe it has been a success, so we're further down the road, as Gordon has alluded to, And I think there are now real benefits beginning to show, not just greater subject choice for the students, not just better articulation opportunities, not just better employment opportunities. Certainly in our new supercampus, there's a new 21st century learning facilities. I think in the written paper I submitted, you can clearly see a huge increase in our performance. Before merger, before the reforms, if you will, our colleges in Glasgow that I represent were below average. Now we're not only above average, we're actually sector leading in that regard. I think there's a stronger student voice. I think, as the First Minister saw herself, there is a world-class college sector, particularly in the city of Glasgow now. And I think we have, as a sector, we now have colleges of scale, of influence. We have colleges now with an enhanced reputation. Yeah, certainly in the pace that we carried out much of the reforms, there were bumps and wrinkles. But I think overall this has been a success story. It's been a success story for the students. It's been a success story for the sector. And indeed, it's been a success story for the staff. Staff, certainly in my college, benefit from higher salaries. They benefit from more holidays. They benefit from more promotion opportunities. They benefit from having better working environment. And, you know, I think when you look at the overall picture, you know, the college reforms, as challenging as they were, they have delivered for students first and foremost, they have delivered for staff, and they have delivered for our college sector.
Thank you, Paul. Annette.
Thanks, Convener. From my perspective, looking at what the reforms were intended to deliver and the things that in Edinburgh College we're really working hard to achieve are better choices for students, not necessarily more choices, but certainly better choices, more coherence for individual students and groups of students, much, much better pathways. And I think fundamentally a completely different relationship between the college, local authorities, employers, and the benefit that we can now offer in terms of community planning, both for our young people but also for our local economy. So I think all of these are really good things to deliver. Like Gordon, I'm a little bit cautious that we don't mix up whether these reforms have been advanced quicker or slower of themselves without taking into account the economic challenges, because there are economic challenges and economic knock-on effects in different regions across Scotland. And I'm very optimistic about the future of our college. I'm more cautious than Paul about how far we are in terms of delivering that. I still think we've got a long way to go in terms of real employer engagement and not just checking things out with employers. We've got a long way to go to articulate the learner pathway from S4 to the end of college or university. And whilst I think we've made a real start on things like improving our curriculum offer, improving pathways, I think there are real challenges for our students in terms of their funding and how easy it is for them to stay at college.
Okay, thank you very much to all of you. But I'm going to start the question with Mary.
Thank you. Can I just say that at the outset, when I read the two submissions from Glasgow and Edinburgh, they couldn't be more different. One was positive, it was successful, it was an increase in part-time and full-time higher education and FE, an increase right across the board. Real benefits, totally positive. And to be honest, as a member of the Audit Committee, I've heard not so good words about the FE sector, particularly Cote Bridge recently, but when I read the Glasgow one, I thought, this is wonderful, it's what everyone's looking for. And then I read the Edinburgh one, and to be honest, I thought it was quite depressing. Working hard to achieve, a long way to go. All we hear about are the problems, and the merger has been so difficult. So my first question, Convener, is why in our two biggest cities in Scotland can Glasgow, the City of Glasgow College, under the leadership of Paul Little, why can so much be done in a positive way to enhance the student experience, allow greater opportunities to move forward? And I know your capital build, I had the pleasure of visiting the Riverside campus recently, Convener, and it would be a proud thing for any student or any member of staff to work there. But, you know, why is one so positive and one so negative? That's my first question.
Thanks, Convener. We certainly didn't set out to write a negative response for the committee. What we sought to do was to try to give a balanced view of where we believe we are in the college sector. I think many people are aware of the fact that Edinburgh is in need of a significant transformational change. To come with an over-positive view to this committee, I think, would have been unhelpful, because I think there are things we still have to do in Edinburgh College, which I think will bring about the kind of transformation that I've set out in my transformation plan for the college. At an individual student level, Convener, I believe the students in Edinburgh College get a very good experience. And I think if you were to look at our student experience, our students would tell you that's a good experience. But it would be disingenuous of me to come to this committee and say that everything in Edinburgh College is the way I would wish it to be. And I think we have some way to go on that.
You've basically pointed out the difficulties, the challenges, the risks, the meaningful engagement is variable. If I was a student reading that and deciding whether I'd go to Edinburgh or Glasgow, it would be a no-brainer. I'd be riding that train to Glasgow. So I would just like to hear from Paul Little as to why you've managed to overcome the same challenges. Edinburgh's had no different challenges to Glasgow. Why is it you've been able to overcome them and to move forward?
Oh, it's a challenging question, Mary. I'm not going to get into the politics of the two cities. I'll avoid that one. You'd be very welcome if you came to Glasgow again in that train.
And a wee bit old for education.
I think at the heart of our change effort, and remember we're a bit further down the road, is that we kept the students very much at the centre. We have a college purpose statement. We don't have mission statements or vision statements. Those are kind of management jargon. We use a concept, plain English. We talk about our purpose and our way. And our purpose is very, very simple. It's to let learning flourish. So every single thing we have done in the reforms and the design of new buildings and the change to our teaching approach and the big emphasis that we have put on performance has been for one reason and one reason only, to let learning flourish, to ensure that every individual student, and there's over 30,000 full and part-time students at the City of Glasgow, to ensure every individual student flourishes, whatever the background. So we have students from BME that since reforms, their success rate's up. We have students who are from a disabled background, their success rate's up. We have students, if you like, from underrepresented sections, their success rates are up. Our higher education is up 12%. Our further education, which accounts for about 40%, is up 19%. I think it's a huge team effort. I think our board was fully engaged. I think our management team was very focused on the learner. And I think our staff weren't distracted from the core activity, which was learning and teaching. And I think that's been enhanced by having a compelling vision of a positive change. We've always seen this as a positive change. We've embraced it as a positive thing. It hasn't been imposed on us. We've embraced that. But also, I think the staff have the opportunity to benefit from, if you like, a next generation. If you like, what reform's done for Glasgow and City of Glasgow College is give us a chance to reset our approach. If you had to start all over again, what you're doing, whatever activity, you get a chance to think all your fundamental approaches. So we did that, and we got a chance to reframe all our priorities, and we reframed them back, if you will. We give the college back to the students, and maybe less away from the teachers.
But no, that's very interesting. But fundamentally, you started, what, 2 years earlier than Edinburgh?
I assume so, yeah.
Correct,
yeah,
yes. Yeah, I mean, roughly speaking, yeah. 2 years. Is it not fair to say that, you know, you've just got a 2 year of a head start on some of the other colleges in terms of the process? And that's partly the reason why there's the difference. But also, I've seen some of the changes. Clearly, you had some challenges in the early stages of those mergers, but also you've now got a world-class facility.
Well, I think actually we started 3 years because we actually merged in 2010, but ultimately I think I'm not going to directly make a comparison with any other college. I think it's about how we planned that approach and the focus that we put on the outcome of that that change process. So, yeah, I hope that within the fullness of time, all the colleges can see the benefits and flourish from that. So maybe time has helped us.
Okay. Sorry, Mary.
I'd just like to go on to the reduction in learning activity, which has been well documented over the last few months. But from the Audit Scotland reports, we've got the cut in reduction in part-time students over 150,000, the cuts to under-16s, which is an SDS issue, over 20,000, and a reduction in the over-25 places at college, 74,000. Now, I appreciate that they're not all happening in Glasgow, but also in the same Audit Scotland report here, the reduction in Scottish Funding Council income between 2012 and 2014 was 166 million. That is a huge cut under, you know, it's about a third cut to the college sector. So what I would really like to ask is, you know, how are small businesses concerned about this? What's happened to the under-16s? The Wood Commission was supposed to enhance the experience of under-16s, having a day or half a day in college, the vocational experience. And for those over 25s, have we focused so much on apprenticeships that we're not allowing that second chance that people like myself got in further education for the over 25s? So the cut by 166 million from the Scottish Funding Council and the huge cuts in part-time under-16s and over-25s. Is the college being allowed to provide the opportunities due to funding, or is the SDS not fulfilling its role in terms of giving opportunities to people?
I think our funding is distinctly different from the Scottish Funding Council. In terms of that, our modern apprenticeship programme is growing. The relationships with colleges in terms of delivery of that programme, I think, is growing. I don't think the reduction in activity can be attributed to Skills Development Scotland in that sense. Our main work... Our main development programmes just now, and we're working with, I think, 20 colleges this year, is around the development of the foundation apprenticeship model, which we've piloted in Fife and West Lothian over the last 2 years. We'll have around 300 young people in the programme this year, and with an expectation in 16-17 of over 1,000 young people undertaking foundation apprenticeships, probably with school college partnerships, and I think it's a really exciting development.
Okay, thank you. Barry?
Yeah, the issues that small businesses come to us about are purely focused on skills and recruitment. So we know that 22% of small businesses in Scotland recruit college leavers, which has been fairly stable over the last few years. You know, when we have discussions with smaller firms, it is on that basis and not on whether colleges are sufficiently resourced to deliver what the government wants them to.
Okay, thank you. Paul?
At the City of Glasgow College, we are very fortunate in that 60% of our income comes from the Funding Council and about 40% is non-Funding Council income. So in that period, we have seen a huge increase, something in the region of about 60-65% growth in the non-SFC income to compensate for the SFC income. I think at one stage we were losing in the region of something like 16% of our grant. Huge numbers in that sense. I think because we are a college of scale and very entrepreneurial, we could compensate for that. We had an international dimension, which helps. We have very strong links with the business community. We work with between 1,000 and 1,500 businesses. I think the forms that you talk about, Mary, under 16 years of age for the students, I think we have delivered those and are continuing to do that. For example, we work with some of the local schools in Glasgow to provide higher education units in the senior phase. So, if you will, we're trying to pioneer this approach of a seamless activity from school to college, opportunities at college, both at technical, associate professional, indeed higher professional, right then through to university level. For example, we articulated since these reforms, since merger, well over 7,600 students articulated from the City of Glasgow College straight to university. But we also had 1,500 students who stayed at the City of Glasgow College and studied their undergraduate degrees in specialist areas. So I think it's about that partnership with industry. It's about having that provision that is resilient to the funding pressures. And I think having that entrepreneurial spirit that we inherited and then we further developed allowed us to, if you like, cushion some of the challenges. But they were challenges, and there's no doubt about it. They did complicate the quite significant change agenda.
Annette.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think in terms of the areas that Paul's just outlined, like the international work that we do and the commercial work that we do, that certainly does help to mitigate economic pressures. But Edinburgh College has worked also with the council to provide more school college places. So we're doing a lot more in our academies work. We're doing the kind of work pulling through into higher education. And we have a good outturn for our students. 96% of our students who were able to track go into positive destinations. So that element of it is positive. That is definitely a funding pressure on us. Our regional outcome agreement was predicated on a 1% reduction in budget year on year, and that money's flowing through to other colleges. And there's a difficult unintended consequence around any college that doesn't recruit in a given year having their funding clawed back in that year, because what happens then is you still have the staffing bill and you still have the overheads, but you have a reduction in your budget, and that then has a knock-on effect the next year. So there are budgetary pressures. There are things that we do to mitigate them, including the international and the commercial work. But the key thing we're doing at the moment is reviewing and rewriting the curriculum, because if the bulk of the demand is coming from students who are coming straight from school, and we have a huge demand from students for whom they don't yet, when they're leaving school, have the entry qualifications for some of our courses. Well, we're the only college in the area, so it's down to us to write those entry qualifications for them. So a big effort that we're making, which will help us both financially and serve our communities better, are these entry-level courses for students leaving school at 16, 17 or 18. And we're doing that to mitigate some of the economic pressures on the college.
Okay, thank you, Annette.
Final question, Convener. Yep. I'll just put all the questions into one because not everyone would have to answer this. I would first of all like to ask about national pay bargaining, and I'd just like to let my colleagues see that I brought along re-elect Alec. James is delighted about that, and his commitment to collective bargaining and its terms and conditions across Scotland, the same terms and conditions for staff across Scotland. So as you can see, that's 2011. So 2016, 3 months out of the election, we still don't have national pay bargaining. And I raise that, Convener, because I was an FE lecturer, as you know, but my colleagues in the UHI, where I was Inverness, they are paid up to £7,000 lower than college lecturers elsewhere in Scotland. So it's quite a significant disparity. So I would like to ask the two, Annette Bruton and Paul, where we are on national pay bargaining and when it is going to happen. My second question is on the regional boards. We heard that the Scottish Funding Council were invited to leave the regional board in Glasgow for some reason a wee while ago. So I would like to ask Paul Little, is your success in Glasgow due to the efficiency and effectiveness of the regional board, or is your success despite the regional board? Because I'm aware that there's no regional board in Edinburgh. And just the final question, Convener, probably for everyone. And it's really, we were also promised that the mergers would bring improvements in the quality of learning. And I would just like, particularly from Barry McCulloch, to ask if, you know, there has been a significant improvement in the quality and how that's measured. Thank you.
Let's try and... Not everybody has to answer all those questions.
No, I appreciate that.
Yep, but, so yeah. let's start with Paul and Annette on that.
I think I have to answer most of those, Mary. Thanks very much. I think the national pay bargaining is a process. It's not an event. I think there's a sign in the shop I once seen.
It says for 5 years.
Yeah. And it's coming to an end. I think let's be honest, we have achieved national bargaining for support staff. We have achieved that. Which is a huge endeavour. I mean, we haven't had national bargaining for goodness nearly 20 years. So to think that we can get it inside, you know, X number of months or even, you know, over a year is probably not realistic. I think the challenges of national bargaining require a team effort between the Scottish Government, the college sector and the trade unions. I think the Scottish Government have to help with transition monies to help that. That's a huge effort that hasn't been forthcoming. I think there's earnest efforts from the college sector to get the decision-making right. I think the teaching unions are frustrated that we haven't achieved that. And I think the frustration is probably more to do with the internal mechanisms that we have as colleges to have, a robust consultative mechanism that ensures that the boards, as the employers, have a fair say and can shape that. And I think that we have made an offer to the teaching unions. We are still locked in intensive discussions. As I said before, we have settled with the support staff. I would hope that that we can achieve with the teaching side the national bargaining, not just the framework, but a settlement. But it does require that team effort, Scottish Government, colleges and the trade unions all taking a realistic approach. As for the regional board, I think we're now over 2 years in Glasgow with the regional board. I think the colleges, three colleges in Glasgow, have got on excellently to work together. We have agreed a curriculum to 2020. We have ensured that we've focused on student success. The regional board is the regional board. It's doing its own business and it's trying to get itself settled down and so forth, and it's trying to add some value. Let's hope it does.
Add value.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not going to let you back in there, Paul. Okay. Annette, on both those points?
Yeah, briefly, convener. Edinburgh board, the board at Edinburgh is both the regional board and the college board, so it's a single board, so the situation is different. With regard to national bargaining, the settlement with the sports staff this year and the uplift of 1% that we agreed to pay our teaching staff put me £500,000 further into the red, but I am 100% behind national bargaining. I think it's the right way to go. I think we do need to accelerate the pace, and I think we need to look at the college funding mechanism alongside the review of pay and conditions, but I think we also need to look at who are all the professionals that support students' learning. So I think we need to have a wider review. I think the mechanism is in place and it's begun to work on the support side, but I think we've got a good bit to do, and I would agree that we need to accelerate the pace around both terms and conditions and national bargaining.
I'll come back to you, Paul, if I get a chance, but Barry?
To follow on from those points, 3 to 4 years ago, if you were to speak to businesses about the role of colleges and their impact in the economy, you would have got a fairly negative answer, I think. I think now we're getting better. It's taking time. The answers that our members and other businesses point to in terms of skill shortages and how they're being addressed by the college system is starting to feed through. But how the system on the whole and how schools and colleges instill the types of character and soft skills that small businesses are looking for, whether that be communication, problem solving, you know, there's still a huge journey to take because for the last two years, about a quarter to a third of small businesses have highlighted skill shortages as a key barrier to growth, and how the college sector as a whole addresses them is unclear at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Mark.
Thanks, Camilla. I'm glad to hear that from both principals supporting national pay bargaining and seen that coming in at a faster pace. Can I ask both of you if both of your colleges have agreed pay harmonisation across all the former campuses?
Yes, is the answer.
Yes, in terms of pay harmonisation, not in terms of terms and conditions. And I think my point, Chair, was that alongside national bargaining, which is the salary increase, and deservedly so, is the equally important necessity to modernisation of the workforce, to modernisation of the terms and conditions. So whereas we were able to agree with our trade unions that we could pay them more, we still can't agree that we could alter their terms and conditions. And that's a big challenge, particularly when you're working with industry, to have conditions that make it flexible so you can be responsive to industry. So as a college, we have found that difficult. And as a sector, we have found it difficult to get the unions to be even wanting to discuss the modernisation of their terms and conditions.
Sorry, I mean, just for the avoidance of doubt, we have harmonised both terms and conditions and pay.
So the barrier in Glasgow has purely been trade unions refusing to even enter a discussion on terms and conditions in terms of pay harmonisation, or is it a reluctance to discuss before national pay bargaining comes into place, or what? Just so it can be clear on harmonisation terms and conditions.
We have industrial harmony at the college. I don't want to open that up, but we did at one point agree with the local trade unions and indeed the staff to have a vote on revised terms and conditions, and the staff voted in favour, a majority, and then the officers of the branch and the national officers ignored that vote, and we were back to zero again. So to a certain extent, I think our challenge is that we were probably harmonising maybe four or five sets of terms and conditions from a wide variety of legacy colleges, and I think Glasgow enjoyed some of the very best terms and conditions in the whole sector, and you can imagine that there would be some staff that were reluctant to give those up. So I think it's a work in progress. I don't think that has any way hampered the commitment to our teachers, to the student success, and in fact our performance rates show that that hasn't been the case. And I think we will continue to debate and discuss with the unions in a constructive way at a local college level. And we will obviously continue, as some of our senior staff are, positively supporting national bargaining and the discussions that are associated with the modernisation of the terms and conditions. It is a work in progress. There's a lot at stake, and obviously we want to make sure we get it accurately negotiated.
Okay. My second question was on the quality of learning. Annette, you'd said that of your students, 96% were going on to positive destinations. I wonder if you can give any other statistics as to what the change has been pre-merger and post-merger as to the percentage of students going on to positive destinations, the percentage of students achieving passes in their courses. What range of statistics are you using to measure success pre and post reform?
Thank you, Convener. The measures that we are using to look at the student experience there's two groups of measures we're using. We're using student feedback surveys, so we look at what students say about the student experience, and we look at the performance indicators that are published nationally. So we look at our performance indicators and how well we have completed courses, both in the further education and higher education sector, and the degree to which students have achieved what they set out to achieve. This year, we have made some improvements in full-time HE and FE, and our performance indicators aren't as good as they were last year on part-time FE and HE. I haven't brought those figures with me today, but I can certainly make those available to the committee. The main reason why the further education statistics where they are down is because students are completing the units of their courses, but they're not completing the full course. And I think that's something that we can turn around within this year. I think it's something that we've already put measures in place to make sure that that doesn't happen again. And I'm sure that we'll see a significant improvement in those performance indicators this year, because it's about resulting, not the quality of work. Students are very positive about being in Edinburgh College, and the feedback from students about their courses is positive. We do very well in higher education courses, and the students who go on to the degree pathways from Edinburgh College to a range of universities, but in particular to Napier and Queen Margaret University, are very positive.
In terms of Glasgow, according to the last set of funding council figures, City of Glasgow College is the third most popular destination for school leavers proceeding on to higher education after Strathclyde University and after Glasgow University. In terms of success rates, our full-time success rates in higher education have increased pre-merger to post-merger from 64% to 76%. In part-time, they've increased from 75% to 78%. And in further education, full-time, they've increased from 53% to 72%. And from part-time FE from 72 to 82%. And our student satisfaction rate is 94%. And of that, that's 94% of students are satisfied with the college, 90% of students are satisfied with their course, 89% would recommend their course to a friend, and 93% would recommend the college.
Thank you. Liam?
Yeah, can I take you back? I was like Mary, slightly baffled by the discrepancy in the reports from Edinburgh and Glasgow College in relation to their experience. But I think it's not just, is it fair to say, that Glasgow started 2 years earlier, but it wasn't driven by legislation and it was backed by a merger fund. The minister at the time suggested that there would be £50 million of recurrent savings that would support the merger process. Now, Audit Scotland's indicated that no such efficiencies were delivered. So is that not a more accurate reason as to why Glasgow finds itself where it is and Edinburgh is experiencing the challenges that it faces?
I'm not so sure, Liam, it is. I think...
You don't agree that having a merger at your own discretion in your own time backed by a merger fund is a considerably more straightforward proposition than have it driven by legislation and with the backdrop of cuts and also in the absence of the £50 million that ministers were suggesting would be delivered through efficiencies?
I agree to a point, absolutely, what you just said. However, you know, all colleges were free to merge before 2010. You know, the City of Glasgow College looked to the funding landscape, and actually, because of our plans for the building, we had to anticipate that that would go down. So we approached the funding council as colleges that were working very closely together and sought money from the funding council at that stage. Any college or any set of colleges in Scotland were equally entitled to do that. Now, yes, we did receive money. For example, we received £2.5 million from the funding council for that. And yes, it would have been great if all colleges had received that. But one of the things that the City of Glasgow College did for the sector was to produce a report, which we circulated with our lessons learned. We established a merger research centre. We shared openly all our documents and all our approaches. And at one stage, we were assisting 20 colleges in Scotland with their mergers, and actually we were helping to project manage three actively in support of their mergers. Yes, the money helped. I think the team effort, it was an enormous effort that the boards put in Glasgow. It was an enormous effort that the managers put in. It was an enormous effort the teachers put in to keep focused on the learning. So maybe we had first mover advantage, maybe we had initial funding, but I'd like to think that the lessons learned that we learned painfully were able to share, be shared with the other colleges to help them compensate for the money. I think the slight difference was that we did our merger in four phases. I think the other colleges had a shorter time span, And I think let's not forget that on top of the merger, you had huge amount of other reforms that distracted the managers at that time. Now, we didn't have those at that time, so we didn't have regionalisation or reclassification or a refocused curriculum and all the other ones that I mentioned before. I think we anticipated, we couldn't anticipate them all, but we anticipated that some of them were coming down the track. And I think, you know, Glasgow is, as a city, is a very progressive city, and I think we just tapped into that and, you know, tried to get ahead.
Thank you, Convener. I've looked into this and tried to understand the answer to this question really since I took up post last summer. And it seems to me, looking at it, and you know, we all have better hindsight than we've got foresight, but it seems to me that looking at it, the business case for Edinburgh College was really very optimistic. The business case set out to reduce 240 full-time equivalent posts in a two-year period, at a time where there was also an agreed no redundancy policy. So we did get funding, the college did get funding at that time from the Funding Council to support a voluntary severance scheme, and that went some way to helping to make the college the shape it wanted to be. But one of the, looking back on it, one of the ways in which the college could have done things differently was to look at the amount of frontline management and promoted post structure for teachers, because the college planned to take out 60% of management posts. Now, nobody wants to spend too much money on management, but I think that left our college in a short of the kind of people who drive the change on the curriculum side. So I think, although we did have some funding to support the college going forward in voluntary severance, 18 months ago, again before I took up post, but it's well documented, the college asked the Funding Council for a significant increase in their cash for that year to invest in the college, to help to turn the college around. Some small sum of money was coming, I think about 2.5 million was asked for, and the college was able to get £300,000. That's the kind of investment the college needed at that time. And so therefore, without being able to hold reserves, it's difficult to see how colleges can make that investment when they need to for transformational change. So I do think that more investment at that stage would really have helped Edinburgh College.
In terms of the student experience, we've seen figures from the Funding Council suggesting enrolments between 2010-11 and 2014-15 dropped from around 383,000 to 297,000, and that headcount dropped from 306,000 to 227,000. What's been the experience in Glasgow and Edinburgh in terms of those opportunities, particularly on a part-time basis? And could you also perhaps address the concerns that have been raised by NUS Scotland about the availability of bursary support, indications that I think around 70% of bursary support in colleges has now been maxed out, with questions arising as to how students will be able to sustain themselves on their courses for the remainder of the term?
Thank you, Convener. We will be able to support our students this year. We've projected forward, but it's actually very tough. The bursary support is very, very tight. We have some emergency fund that we help our students with as well. Our student numbers have dropped, partly, I think, because we could do more to recruit, but also the job seekers allowance figures have dropped in this area, so we've got fewer of those students. And two of our universities dropped their entrance levels, and that made a material effect. So we've had a drop overall, but we've had a 1% decrease in our credits year on year on year, and we've transferred credits to other colleges as well. So yes, we felt the effect of a reduction in student places. We are trying to support our students, though, as best we can, given the current student position in Scotland for colleges.
Yeah, we still have part-time students. Roughly just under two-thirds of the college is part-time. There's no doubt about it that the college and the sector has been refocused from lifelong learning to developing Scotland's young workforce to prioritising 18 to 24-year-olds. However, we still have been able to attract and support part-time learners. And I think the other challenge that you mentioned was bursary support. You know, it's a real pressure. It's a real pressure for all the colleges in Glasgow, and my college in particular, particularly as we have planned to increase the number of full-time further education students at the college. I think we're having to dip into some of our own monies to support that. And I hope that additional bursary money can be found, because it makes the difference between a young person coming to college or not. It's that simple.
Thank you. George, Adam?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I would like to ask about developing Scotland's young workforce. You mentioned it there, Paul. You know, a key part of college reform was the refocus, as you've already mentioned. And I would like to talk about the tale of two cities, colleges, effectively, here, where we have the Wood Commission. One of the things that came up with the Wood Commission was the fact that building relationships with business was extremely important, and one of the key parts of regionalisation was that you'd be a better place to do that. But from what we've heard this morning, it seems that Glasgow seems to be in a good place, but Annette mentioned that more work could be done on that employee engagement. You know, where are we with both? Where exactly are we with both colleges at this point?
Okay, well, Glasgow's in a great place in a sense that we have planned to refocus our approach to, away from, if you will, academic industry departments to industry academies. So we have 100 planned, and in our second year of that planning, we have delivered 28. So these are, this whole approach is an approach where we work really closely with businesses. We get the business to help set the assignments for the students. We have several thousand students, maybe 3,000 students at any one time, and if you will, in student experience. We have 40 staff at the minute in doing industrial placements. We have students who are, you know, getting inputs from industry bodies to, you know, show what the industry standard is required. We have tried to ensure that we're teaching to the industry standard. How do we know that? Well, we take part in skills competitions sponsored by industry. City of Glasgow College is ranked number one in the United Kingdom for its technical and professional skills. It also delivered a membership of the UK squad in world skills. So we've got, if you culinary arts, to world-class level. I think it's our approach is very much focused on delivering for Glasgow and indeed delivering wider than that, because we have a number of national centres of expertise, so we're delivering in UK terms and even internationally. That's probably partly to do with our legacy. The City of Glasgow College was very much a higher education hub, working closely for a number of years with industry, and I think we're just going to continue to raise that game.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is an area, actually, where many parts of Edinburgh College actually excel. And many of our young people, both those part-time and in work and those working in our full-time courses, have very good links with industry. We've got a large number of placements. We have industry quality facilities in the college where industry come in and work with us on that. So I think we have a very positive story to tell. Like Glasgow College, we win a lot of industry awards and we have a lot of industry events inside the college. The area where I think there's a need for policy to look again, and you know, the committee was wanting to look at the policy today, I think the area where the policy needs to look at is how we make it easy for employers, particularly small and medium-sized enterprises, to engage with schools, colleges and universities without that being done in a piecemeal way. We have very, very good employment relationships with our departments in the college, but I'm really keen to see us develop further a way, particularly for small businesses, to be able to be asked once, contribute once, and be able to talk to schools, colleges and universities all at the same time, rather than the effect at the moment, which is lots of people putting a lot of demand on small businesses' time. And I think we could get more leverage for community planning and for economic development in an area by improving that element of our work.
Can I ask?
Barry had a comment.
I was just going to ask that. Yeah.
Sorry, apologies, George.
I was going to ask Barry and Gordon what their opinions were of with regards to the same question. Effectively, what is the interaction? Because it's always been a complaint from the Wood Commission on that the interaction hasn't been great. Are we further forward?
I think I'd probably say no, because I think if you reflect back on the Wood Commission and the government's DIW response to that, they were quite clear that employers and businesses had to shape and benefit from the wider education system. Now, there's a seven-year plan. We're very early days. But what strikes me is how little we know about the relationship between small businesses and colleges. You know, based on the report we published 2 weeks ago with regard to schools, you know, there's things that we can tease out. But you know, I think there's a need to unpack this notion of industry and concentrate on the 98% of small businesses that are in and around the college network and deliver what they need. And to be honest, I think we're getting there. I think the point that Annette made is an important one. We're reaching a stage where there's multiple groups forming and we could substantially over-egg the pudding. And there's a need to rationalise and focus the effort at a regional level. The colleges have the right scale, they have the focus, but it's the colleges working with the schools and giving the access point to the local business community, which is still not there.
In small businesses in particular, is that not a legacy from the past? Because it's always difficult to engage with, to be fair to everyone,
yeah,
with small businesses, because basically small businesses are, by their term, it's basically one person that's trying to push the business forward, and they just need somebody there and then to actually deal with the issue. So it's a difficult one to begin with. You know, it's not like dealing with larger industry and kind of they've got 10-year plans, 5-year plans. A lot of businesses are just looking at the here and now and how they're going to progress. So that's something we need to work on, but it's one that's a legacy from forever, as far as I can tell. Coming from a self-employed, small business family background.
Absolutely. I think when you review the policy and the history around this, we've been talking about this, you know, for well over a decade, and it's something that we haven't cracked yet. What we found from our research related to schools, and I see no conflict with the college sector either, is that although there's small numbers engaging, how they engage, how committed they are, you know, what they're willing to do, whether that be work experience, classroom talks, guidance on entrepreneurship, guidance to the principals, they are willing to do it, but they do need to be asked. And were we to design a system, which we're about to engage in meaningful, proactive, grassroots engagement at, you know, a very ultra-local level, you would build up the relationships, you would break down the barriers, you know, between staff, and I think the outcomes would flow from that. We see that businesses that are engaged in schools, you know, that leads to better outcomes for the young person, but also for the business. You know, there's a wage premium on business engagement. There's better outcomes in relation to lower levels of not in education, employment or training. And it's a win-win situation. There's just a need to galvanise the whole system across Scotland to deliver what businesses need.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with a lot of the comments that Barry made. I attended the national DYW group last night. Rob Woodward, MD at STV, chairs that group. So that was the first time that the groups had all come together. Glasgow probably up and running now for over a year. Strong private sector leadership from the Chamber, backed by a strong private sector board. And others are actually coming now through the system. They're getting 3 years funding from government in terms of setting up and supporting that. So those groups, I think, will be important in terms of providing the glue to bring education and business together. I was quite enthused last night. A lot of positive contributions from across the country. I'll probably get more experience of the work across the three Ayrshires, where the local authorities had always a strong relationship with the Chamber in terms of support and work experience, and I think they see it building on that. The challenges you highlighted for engagement with small business was one of the themes that they discussed within the working groups last night, so it's definitely on their radar. But there are practical issues around actually small businesses obviously getting time out of the day-to-day run of their business to commit into a school curriculum, and with little opportunity to chop and change at the last minute to the pressures of business. So I was certainly enthused last night around the work and the progress, the DYW groups, but I think there's more to be done, and it's a challenging environment to do that on an ongoing basis. We've provided into each of the groups regional skills assessments. So fairly detailed analysis of regional economic geographies, which will hopefully help them set priorities in terms of how they set out their business plan. We'll be working with them around their kind of key performance indicators as well, around things like modern apprenticeships and equality and diversity agenda.
Okay, one final question. It's basically, the colleges have always delivered, or have been known for delivering vocational, and the focus is on vocational education at the moment. And obviously, to deliver for business, that's what we need to be going for. So what specific changes have actually taken place as a result of the Wood Commission and the Scottish Government's refocus on this? And also, how have partnerships developed with local authorities? I know there was areas highlighted in the Wood Report. In fact, Renfrewshire was one of them, Reed Care College, as was, and Renfrewshire Council and working together, and the Chamber working together. So where have these partnerships been successful? Where have they been developed? And where have we gone with that?
I think a particular strength of Edinburgh College has been the work that we've done with our three local authority areas, and we are not just represented but active at all levels in the community planning partnership. And that includes on the skills groups, on the workforce groups, on the economic development groups. I'm supporting East Lothian Council by leading their poverty commission. So, and sitting alongside that, we've refreshed our entire approach to employer councils. So we now have employer councils in every curriculum area in the college. Those have been refreshed this year. And we're trying to make it easy for employers not just to contribute to commenting on the effectiveness of our courses, but actually at the stage of designing the courses. So that's made a major difference. We've increased the number of students who get more regular placements, and we've increased the number of college partners, business partners, who actually come in and do work in the college with us. So I think there's a bit to go still in terms of the DYW agenda, but I think it's an area where we're seeing a significant shift in our vocational orientation, both in further and in higher education.
Visited City of Glasgow College as one of the first colleges to learn what we were doing because of the very close links that we had with industry and our partnership with schools. So we have managed to pioneer, if you like, putting higher education, or if you like, higher vocational education into the senior phase of schools with working with the local authority very successfully. That's an extension, if you will, of the School Links programme. But we've also supported some novel and innovative, if you like, developments such as Newlands Junior Academy, Jim McCall's sponsored academy. We provide all the vocational expertise for that. So that's, I feel like, a very specialised solution, trying to help hard to help young people get back into education and then on to education, onto employment. The college also works really closely with the Chamber of Commerce. I sit on the board of the Chamber of Commerce, and I was smiling when I heard Gordon talking about the work of Glasgow Chamber of Commerce, because I commented to the Chief Executive only last week that a third of his report was based on education. I'd never seen that before in the 9 years I'd been associated with the Glasgow Chamber of Commerce. So increasingly, the Chamber of Commerce is working even more closely with the college than before. We work with the Glasgow Economic Leadership. Glasgow is a very cohesive city, and the three colleges in Glasgow have actually mapped their curriculum to the priorities of Glasgow as it goes forward to 2020, so that we're trying to ensure that we have that pipeline of workforce to replace the, if you like, the skill shortages that are coming down the track. But also, we work very closely with some very large companies. We work with micro companies, but we work with some of the top 10 shipping companies in the world. So I think the full spectrum is there. I think we are seeing students benefiting from that. And one of, for example, we had 245 guaranteed interviews for our students. City of Glasgow College aspires to guarantee all its students jobs in the future.
Nobody else, no?
Pick up, I think, if you look across the college landscape, you can identify real strengths in terms of partnership development activity. I referenced earlier on the work we had done around the energy sector, and there's an energy skills partnership, which is a consortium of the colleges, initially led by Dundee College. They've got a development manager, Jim Brown, and a team around there. And it's, I think, a fantastic example of how they can take curriculum and then share that across the college network. So things like overhead line technicians developed in Inverness, but shared with Fife, Ayr, and then Dumfries and Galloway. in a very rapid process sort of thing, and that's working alongside SSE and Scottish Power, who are doing huge investments into their grid connections. But you can look into Ayrshire and some of the work they've done around their engineering forum, particularly around aerospace, hospitality sector, touched on earlier around West College and what they've been doing with Ferguson's, but you can apply that. I mean, there'll be examples like that across most colleges in areas like Forth Valley, really strong, and things like process engineering. I think sometimes we get a bit frustrated in terms of business that everything's got to be delivered in the local college, and we should recognise that, you know, we're not a huge place and that we should do more sharing and knowledge transfer across the college environments. We're all part of the public sector, funded by the public sector. We should be more collaboration in terms of delivering and meeting needs of industry, and there's certainly some good examples of that emerging.
So that's okay.
Barry.
Now, unquestionably, there's been significant investment in employer-led infrastructure over the last 2 years, and there will be for the next two. I think that the point I was trying to make is that there's a difference between formulating and agreeing a strategy at a high level and the operational delivery on the ground, and how closely we have to watch that to make sure that it's delivering what smaller micro-businesses need. And I think one of the points I would stress at this juncture is the need to make sure that there's sufficient knowledge transfer partnerships taking place between, you know, college staff and business to break down those barriers at a very local level. I think that would go some way to producing more mutual benefits, more mutual learning, because at the moment they are quite different worlds, and there's a degree of mutual misunderstanding about what takes place on the other side.
Thank you. John.
Thanks, Convener. I think probably in response to George Adams' questions, that most of my answers have been given, but I think it's good to, you know, seek the reassurance that, you know, this consultation or sort of cooperation is now working with you know, businesses, and indeed when you look at the, you know, the people that you're involved with, local authorities, schools and employers, I think that's a giant step forward, because there's always a frustration that, you know, any kid who was coming out of college with a qualification then was not going to get a job in description, I think could, you know, get to a stage where was it really worthwhile. But with regards to businesses, you know, I know you, Barry, did say that, you know, you take 22% of college people into small businesses. What's the is there still a willingness, or is this dialogue take place with big businesses, like, as George was mentioning, larger businesses? You know, what kind of dialogue? Because I remember I chaired a conference a couple of months ago, and Paul was one of the speakers there. But what we find that the audience, there were very, very few large employers there. It was more about people who were wanting to deliver, the training and people who wanted to deliver a service. But I found that larger employers didn't seem to be actively involved. Is that barrier kind of breaking down a wee bit?
Yeah, I think it is. Scotland doesn't have that many large businesses. It's almost entirely small and micro in its nature. But what larger businesses can do is they can allocate resources in a much easier way. So the point that we highlighted in the report is that if a micro business with four employees gets involved in a school and provides 2 to 3 hours a month, that is the same of a business of 250 employees hiring a new member of staff. So the time and cost constraints that your most smallest businesses in Scotland find to do this type of thing is challenging, whereas typically larger businesses can allocate specialist resources to corporate social responsibility, employer engagement, whereas in your micro business, the owner is doing multiple jobs. They're running the business, they're doing HR, they're doing legal, and how they bolt all this on top of the commercial pressures that they face is challenging. I would point to the fact that when we spoke to small businesses about their relationship with the education system, they were very willing to get involved because it's an extension of their almost moral altruistic belief that they need to do more to prepare young people for the world of work. So the motivation and the belief is there. It's about getting the mechanism right and shaping the ask and the proposition to get more employers to contribute.
I just wonder, just one further question. I wonder if any of the college sector here would ask, obviously, reform is a big giant step forward for a lot of people, and I think there's a lot of people actually buying into that. But there's still some criticism out there. And the NUS, for example, said that student support is not fit for purpose. And the EIS said that college reforms had not improved education in the sector. Would you like to comment on that?
I would disagree that it hasn't had any benefits to the sector. I think college reform was due. I think it's welcome. And I think it will bring great benefits to the sector. It's certainly helping to turn things around in my college. On the issue of student funding, the fact that college students do not have the security of funding that universities have is a major disincentive for students in Scotland. And it's an area where we're looking at the students who do drop out of college early on in their courses in Edinburgh College, and I think this is probably the case across the sector, cite financial difficulties as the main reason for leaving the course before they're a quarter of the way through it, which is the critical point of counting. So I do believe there are significant pressures on students who are trying to come to college. There are good benefits for people in terms of childcare, so that benefits people, but the pressures on students financially are leading many students in our college to drop out very early in the course.
I think let's not forget that there really was no significant college reform for about 20 years. There was small changes, small initiatives. So if you, after that period of time, if you've got such a huge reform agenda at such speed, it's obvious you'll get that reaction, particularly from the teaching unions. I think reform has delivered transformational change for some colleges and probably transactional change for others, in the sense that it's been a major step change for some. For some, it's a work in progress, or it's larger and more of the same, but hopefully will develop into something better within time. I think the pressures that the students that we serve in the colleges is ever growing. We were pleased, I suppose, that we had flat cash settlement. We were possibly expecting a further cut to the college budgets. We were pleased it was flat cash. We're looking ahead to see what might happen in the future. We don't want any further cuts to the college sector, because ultimately it doesn't affect the institutions per se, it affects the people we serve. And I think the students that we serve are amongst the most vulnerable in Scotland and in Glasgow. So we work really hard to try to convince the policymakers that they should ring fence, if you like, bursary monies that we would support NUS in calling for more of that, simply because, as I said earlier, if those monies are not available, then students don't attend college. Students that we serve have got challenging backgrounds, and that support money isn't a lot of money at the end of the day, but that support money makes the difference between being able to afford to travel to college, being able to subsidise their living expenses, or actually getting a part-time job and staying at home. So ultimately, any additional monies that we can get, particularly to support the bursary monies or our students or indeed the sector, is very, very welcome, but actually is very, very needed.
Could you just ask one for a question?
Very brief.
Could you maybe advise us, what is the dropout percentage in?
Across the country, I think it's about 5%, 5 to 6%. It varies from college to college.
I don't know that figure, obviously, yeah. It's IT with yeah. that.
We can certainly provide that to the committee if that would be helpful.
Thank you very much. Chair Brody.
Thank you. Good morning. If my question is a bit robust, it's not a critique, it's to help me elicit a better understanding of what is going on. There's something missing. We had number of attendees last year at colleges of 119,000. If you add in the SFC and the European Social Fund, 121,000, and another 598 for the SRUC. But there were only 671 presented by SDS. Now, perhaps you can explain, and I know, because we've engaged, and thank you for your help, Gordon, in terms of the project we did on HGVs. But if I look, and as a consequence of that, did an analysis of employment shortages in Scotland across HGVs, forestry, the hospitality sector, the construction sector. We've got a requirement for about 150,000 to 180,000 people. And that's not 10 years down the road. That's now. What is happening in terms of, I heard about the industry academies. Exactly how do you engage in a meaningful way to, first of all, determine and forecast what's likely to happen by sector? Where's the sectoral analysis that tells us what's likely? And then how do we translate that into the industry academies or the places in the colleges that will develop the and produce the courses that are required to meet the demand, as I say, the shortages that we have? How do you engage?
Give a bit of background. So, Skills Development Scotland works through the industry leadership groups, which are constructs both from Scottish Government, Scottish Enterprise, that help drive economic strategy. Scottish Energy Advisory Board meets in Edinburgh this afternoon. So we have now developed 10 skill investment plans in conjunction with industry leadership groups, which looks at the kind of key and growth sectors.
Yes.
So there's 10 of those: energy, food and drink, tourism, finance, ICT, life sciences, engineering, chemical sciences, construction and creative industries. We've done other pieces of research around areas like textiles, HGV, road haulage that you're aware of just now, and a piece of work on forestry and timber technologies as well. So we produce these, we see industry as the kind of custodians of these, and it's industry that sign the plans off. They're shared through the Joint Skills Committee, which is an advisory group between the Funding Council and SDS. Both Barry and Paul has just joined the Skills Committee. And they really are kind of cornerstone documents on a sectoral basis for colleges to analyse and look at and get a better understanding of where sectoral needs are. November 2014, we also published the regional skill assessments. These are all contained within our websites. We've updated that data this 2 months ago. So this brings together all the economic data that we can garner, outputs from the colleges, from NOMIS, the UK system through DWP, and feedback from Scottish Enterprise in terms of what they see in terms of their growth areas. And again, these are cornerstone documents that we hope, and certainly the Funding Council insist, that the colleges incorporate into the regional outcome agreements in terms of how they would set out the forward plan, how they will meet the needs of local economic development. And the regional outcome agreements are the agreement for funding from the Funding Council to the regional colleges.
It's all very interesting. And I, as you know, I sit on the Economy Committee, where we've discussed before. And we've got all these bodies talking to each other. Now, those of us that are, I'm sure we all are, interested in outcomes and improved productivity and what have you. You talked about all that data you're gathering. And if I go to Annette's report, and by the way, I'm not criticising getting involved between the two cities. God forbid I would do that. But clearly they're at different stages of development, and I'm sure they're sharing the expertise. But if I go to Annette's report, or the Edinburgh report, it says the college sector needs to improve the volume and quality of the employer engagement. And we'll come to that later. I know that one of my colleagues will be doing that. More needs to be done to ensure that the college has the right data to forecast employer needs effectively. So what's happening to the data that you produce? Where is it being translated to an outcome that will generate and fulfil the shortages that we have? Because I don't see it happening.
They are articulated into the regional outcome agreements. So I was looking at the UHIFE regional outcome agreement, and it cites a lot of our material all through it in terms of the industrial sectors of where they're going to prioritise. Our staff undertook sessions with each of the regional colleges, along with the SFC regional outcome managers, in terms of actually sharing the information. There's a narrative report, and then there's a data matrix of around 50 different data sources. perhaps ask colleagues. I mean, we worked with, certainly in Glasgow, across the three regional college structures in Glasgow to share that information. And as Paul said, they have set out a curriculum through to 2020 based on that, what we feel is a rich source of data. And this is data that, for a variety of reasons, there used to be a lot more economic data produced when you had the larger Objective 2 European structural programmes, because that data was required to justify the European funds. Over the last probably 10 years, with changes to the Scottish enterprise structure and local enterprise companies going into the one structure, there's not as much data has been produced. So over the last 2 years, I think we've done a really good job of pulling that information forward. It may be something that we could do in terms of a more general information session for committee members, but there's a real rich source of data there which has been held up with high regard and very positive feedback from the majority of colleagues.
I think that's very helpful, but why, on that basis, and the last question, the basis, have you only submitted, or SDS only through the Employability Fund, secured 671 places when in fact you were set a target of 2,750?
I'm not familiar with those figures. The figures I've got in terms of Employability Fund, are you talking through colleges or through?
Yeah, through colleges. So you were asked to, SDS was asked in a ministerial letter of guidance in 2014-15 to deliver 17,150 training places in total, including 2,650 college places through the Employability Fund.
I think there has been some issues around the colleges, the responsiveness to our funding criteria and to the availability, and some colleges have done it really strongly and others have probably focused more on their core business. So the figures I had for 14-15 were volumes delivered 2,596 through the Employability Fund within the college structure. So we might need to come back and
right, if that's the case, convener, I'd like Spice to have another look at the figures that were presented in the papers to us, because it says quite clearly.
Yes, it does. Can I just, Gordon, if you've got different figures, it would be helpful if you supplied them to us.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Liam? Did you have anything?
I think it's been covered.
You covered it. Okay, thank you. Can I thank the panel for coming in this morning and giving us your time? We'd really appreciate you doing that. And I'm going to suspend briefly before we bring in the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you. Can I welcome Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning, and our accompanying officials, your second panel this morning on college reform. And can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks?
Thank you, Convener. Sorry to hear you're suffering with your throat.
Sorry, yes.
I very much welcome the opportunity to join committee again this morning to discuss the important matter of college reforms, the benefits for learners and businesses alike, and to look to the future, and to look to the future for this valued and valuable sector. I want to start by saying a few words about the sector. Colleges play a crucial role in this government's commitment to improving the employability of all Scotland's young people. Colleges' ability to flex to the needs of industry while attracting young people to courses that better prepare them for the world of work is excellent. Current youth employment levels are at their highest for 10 years, and colleges have played a significant role in that achievement. Quite simply, colleges matter. They make a vital contribution to our people, our economy, and our society. So, Convener, turning to the reform programme, put simply, our overall ambition was to improve young people's life chances and generate the skilled workforce that Scotland needs for economic growth, and of course to ensure the best use of public funds. The essential building blocks of reform were a regional structure, creating colleges of considerable scale and influence, outcome agreements to ensure far greater transparency about the impact of colleges and their contribution to Scottish Government priorities, and to strengthen governance with increased accountability and board effectiveness in improving outcomes for learners and businesses alike. The importance of proper stewardship of colleges, a live issue, cannot be overstated. Good boards can support a college to better the lives of students and to help businesses better perform. They can be a force for good, great good. However, because of their vital role, poor boards could risk actively making things and making things much worse. So let me acknowledge at this point, Convener, as you know, other contributors have pointed out, that a reform programme of this scale and pace has been extremely challenging. Structures have changed very considerably, placing great demands on college leaders and their staff. But to their enormous credit, I mean, we are now beginning to see evidence of the impact of our reforms. Colleges are delivering their targets, their activities more closely aligned to the needs of learners and businesses, and they are having greater impact, and they are a good example of public sector reform. Moreover, the sector is already playing a central role in the delivery of developing the young workforce, Scotland's youth employment strategy, in itself, you know, another major public sector reform. So this is an effort that's relying on the vision, the input and the commitment of many partners, particularly schools and employers. And it is my belief that the regional structure now in place across Scotland and other aspects of reform have been instrumental in terms of the great progress so far. Reforms have given colleges a major role in meeting regional skills needs and the influence and capacity to do so. By way of conclusion, Convener, colleges have implemented the most profound set of public sector reforms in Scottish tertiary education for more than a generation, which is in itself a remarkable achievement. Audit Scotland last year in its Scotland Colleges 2015 report acknowledges many positives, and the report confirms that college finances are sound, that planning for mergers was good, and that the sector has responded well to a period of significant change. So now that the debate over structures is behind us, we must now ensure they work to fulfil their potential, and we must continue to evidence the benefits. And my letter of guidance to the Funding Council published last month sets out priorities for both college and university sectors in what has been a tight financial settlement for public service in Scotland, and I am pleased to have been able to protect college resource funding at 2015-16 levels. And I have been clear of the priority that I attach to continuous improvement in learner outcomes. I recognise that there is more to do, and I look forward to continuing to support the sector in its next phase.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder, you mentioned a lot of the issues surrounding the changes that have taken place because of the reforms, but can you, in a nutshell, tell us what you expected the overall benefits from college reform would be, and whether these have actually been delivered by the reforms?
I mean, I suppose in a nutshell, and to answer your question at a high level, at a high level, convener, I'm sure we'll get into the detail later. I think ensuring that Scotland has a skilled workforce, ensuring that young people leave college with the skills and qualifications that will get them into work. We've certainly seen positive destinations from college leavers. The first time that we've published that information sitting at 81.5%. That's positive destinations into either further study, training or employment. The Funding Council has put a range of measures in place which, the impact of change is continuously monitored. And essentially it's about ensuring that we have the right learning in the right place, and that we have high quality learning that is equipping the workforce for the jobs that exist today and for tomorrow.
Okay, thank you very much. Colin Beattie.
Cabinet Secretary, the Wood Commission recognised the benefits for employers of a strong vocational education system and the positive engagement between employers and education providers. However, the Wood Commission also pointed out that only 29% of employers are recruiting young people directly from education. College of Scotland said that colleges are now act as a regional hub for engagement with employers to deliver the Scottish Government Youth Employment Strategy. And this is particularly said to be helpful for employers who are small to medium businesses. It enables them to engage more effectively. Having said that, has college reform demonstrably improved links between colleges and business? Is there better engagement now than there was before? And are there examples to demonstrate that?
I think what college reform has achieved, along with the developing young workforce agenda, and they are quite inextricably linked, is that they have secured better partnership working actually between colleges, businesses and schools. And when you look at the pace of development around foundation apprenticeships, it started off with two pathways. There are now several pathways crossing, seven key sectors of the economy, with, reaching into, hundreds, I think it's about 300 young people pursuing a foundation apprenticeship. When you look at the other vocational courses that pupils in their senior phase are doing, we've seen a significant expansion from year one to year two. I mean, there are 2,500 senior phase pupils studying a variety of courses and colleges, 170 different types of college courses that these 2,500 students are pursuing. That's over, around 20 or so local authorities and hundreds of schools. And colleges, in my view, have always been particularly good at engaging with local employers, particularly small employers. I've certainly seen evidence of that over the years from the college in my own area, West Lothian College, who are constantly tweaking their provision, you know, what they provide and how they provide it in response to employer need. But I think what college reform and the young workforce agenda has managed to do is to put the architecture in place to ensure that systems-wide change. So, as Ian Wood has often commented about having colleges of scale and influence. Also, you've got the invest in young people groups at a local level as well. Now, obviously, this is an area which is led by Rosanna Cunningham and Annabelle Ewan, but they're a crucial, you know, linchpin, these invest in young people groups, because Colin Beattie is right. It is not acceptable that only 29% of employers employ young people direct from education. And if we are going to address structural youth unemployment, we know youth unemployment is the lowest it's been since 2005, that figure needs to be much, much higher. And of course, there are some important key performance indicators in the young workforce and the youth employment strategy around that.
The evidence we've seen so far indicates a bit of a gulf between the big companies who have the mechanism and structure to be able to engage with the schools and the small to medium businesses which provide the bulk of the employment in Scotland. But they have a much more complicated capability because usually they're small businesses. They haven't got the same time, they haven't got the same resources or facilities, yeah. And yet it's really important that they become engaged. And there seems to be highlighted a certain lack of knowledge as to how to engage effectively, and also, as I said, the complexity in doing that. And has the college mergers helped in that at all?
Well, I believe it has. And, you know, as well as the college mergers, the Invest in Young People groups have an extremely important role in leading the engagement, particularly with SMEs at a local level. I have visited on a few occasions, some members will be familiar with Dundee and Angus College, which is an excellent example of how to engage with businesses of all size in the locality. And I, you know, have went to visit their Code Academy, and you see this breadth of activity, you know, that they're engaged with in a key sector, STEM, you know, ICT, coding. It starts with primary school children, the work they do with senior phase pupils, adult learners, evening classes, as well as their full-time provision in the coding courses. But they're a great example of how to engage with SMEs, and, you know, because of their modern facilities, I mean, they will often have SMEs in actually leading input and, you know, delivering sessions to students and work closely with students in terms of mentoring. So there are exemplars out there, and I would say Dundee and Angus College are one example of that.
I'm pleased to hear about these examples. Just one last question. How do you perceive that the remaining barriers, and there are barriers, to employer engagement be overcome?
I mean the whole ethos of college reform, of the young workforce agenda, was recognising that there are barriers, particularly for the SMEs, and that requires a bit of push and shove on both sides. So there are definitely things that the world of education can do better. It has to be more outward looking. I would contend that it is. Dundee and Angus College are not the only example of a college that engages very effectively with local business. I can think of Forth Valley College, West Lothian College, City of Glasgow College, South Lanarkshire College that I visited recently as well. But the 21 regional groups, they will be led by industry. This isn't about being led by the world of education or, you know, local authorities. They all have an important part to play. Colleges have to be represented in the regional Invest in Young People groups. Community planning partners, local authorities, you know, as the local education provider, have to be round the table. But the regional Invest in Young People groups are led by industry. And I think that will help enormously. And there's an appetite out there. It's not easy for small businesses to be proactively engaging, and we have to be more welcoming and enable that to happen.
Chip Bury.
Good morning. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned increasing productivity and how important the role that the colleges play is in that. And my personal experience with colleges in the south of Scotland, particularly in Ayrshire, it has been a happy one in terms of, although difficult at times, clearly is demonstrating and taking great strides forward. You also mentioned you're talking about the structure, and that structure in college reform is behind us, and you said you're optimistic, you know, that the structure was now in place. I wish I was as optimistic as you were about structure. I don't know if you saw me ask a question of Gordon McGuinness, and I have to say the SDS have been very helpful in some of the projects that we've been doing in helping particular sectors. But, you know, and I asked the question from the SFC statistical publication as to, of the 121,000 places placed in 2014-15, only 671 came through SDS. Now, I know that's under another Cabinet Secretary's portfolio, but 671 out of for employment fund out of 121,000 doesn't seem a lot. I mean, is the structure working?
I mean, I'm not sure that I would necessarily look at colleges and their contribution to employability, to an economy, solely through the prism of things like the employability fund. You know, there are employability funds that come from the funding council and go direct to colleges. And of course, colleges are free to bid for the employability contracts through open procurement along with other training providers. And there's an element of the SDS funding that is, of course, ring-fenced for colleges as well. So I suppose I'm struggling to see, I'm sure Mr. Brodie will enlighten me, the sort of connection between structures and, you know, employability provision.
I think it's important that the structures all hang together in terms of, as I say, I know that the two areas which contribute to the productivity you were talking about and the contribution that colleges make to employment. I'm surprised that your comment regarding a £6 million employability fund for SDS is not directly associated with business and employment. But the situation is, do we have the processes in place? I'll give you an example. And I mentioned again to Gordon McGuinness, who's been very helpful. As a result of an exercise that we did as a consequence of the project on SGVs, and then on forestry, and then hospitality, and then life sciences, that we have an estimated shortage in the workforce of 150,000 to 180,000 people. Not 10 years down the road, but almost immediate. And you're one of the bodies responsible for engaging with the colleges, making sure that skills are there, is SDS. And of course, they also do that through training providers. So I'm kind of surprised when I'm asking about the process and the guidance, because there are two cabinet secretaries involved, and I'm sure the agenda is the same one, that you're unable, or maybe I'm not being clear enough in my questioning, as to why, out of 122,000 places, only 671 places were put into the colleges for employability training.
But the core of what colleges do is about employability. Whether that's about HNC courses, HND courses, and of course, you know, more specific employability courses, whether it's things like certificate for work readiness, colleges participation in, you know, delivering employability fund provisions. I'm not saying, you know, all of that is not important, but the 641 places that Mr. Brodie refers to, I mean, that only accounts for, I suppose, a small proportion of the employability fund activities. But the broader point that I think Mr. Brodie is making is about that broad connectivity and strategic alliance, if you like, between Skills Development Scotland, the funding councils, and of course the colleges. And it is imperative, and you know, all of these organisations work hard to ensure that outcome agreements, you know, are connected with the regional skills plans that are led and, you know, pulled together by skills development colleges. And that is important because while we have a national economy and raising productivity, you know, to increase economic growth throughout our economy is, you know, key plank of the government's economic strategy, it is imperative that we have a good handle on local economies, and of course Mr. Brodie, you know, mentioned the importance of the work that they do in Ayrshire College, and Ayrshire College is a good example of another college that is, you know, making provision, educational provision, that is connected to their local economy.
It is a final point, actually. Here we have demand of labour and labour opportunities. What I'm trying to elicit is, how do we optimise supply, you know, to meet that particular demand? And you know, all the various bodies that are involved. I mean, my understanding was part of the college reform was to ensure the skills and the requirements and the supply was there to achieve that. So, I mean, it's not a question.
I think that's why the Funding Council and SDS have a range of joint planning activities. I mean, those two organisations have to be working hand in glove, you know, to make appropriate plans, you know, in terms of the provision that has to meet, you know, the needs of local economies. I think, you know, I mean, I'm absolutely clear, you know, in my expectations that both organisations have to have that focus on local economies. And I think largely colleges do have that. Is there always room for improvement? Of course there is. Of course there
is. Thank you. Mary.
Thank you. I think we're all familiar with the figures in recent times in terms of college places, the cut of 150,000 part-time, under 16s a cut of 20,000 places, and for the over 25s the cut of 74,000. So in total, almost a quarter of a million places in further education. But the sacrifice of all these places was, we were told, would lead to more full-time places. And because many of the part-time places were referred to as hobby courses. But however, when we look at the full-time places in further education, that's actually gone down by 2,000. So given that, you know, we've got 166 million cut in the Scottish Funding Council funding, it's in Audit Scotland report, 166 million cut, we've got a quarter of a million fewer places, and the promise of the full-time hasn't happened. So what's gone wrong here?
Well, I would obviously dispute that anything has went wrong, and I know in many ways we'll be rehearsing and repeating some familiar arguments, but I mean, nonetheless, I respect that this is an area that members are very interested in and are focused on. I mean, as a government, we made a very clear commitment in our manifesto that we would maintain the full-time equivalent at 116,000 places. That was the measurement that we made a very public commitment to in our manifesto. There are a range of reasons why we feel that's a more rounded measurement, because there are many measurements of activity within the college sector. You know, we prefer the full-time equivalent measurement to, for example, headcount, because headcount, you know, doesn't always reflect the volume of activity associated to individual courses. We know that with very short courses, that 142 very short courses can be equivalent to one full-time course. So as opposed to, you know, cut to the chase with Mrs. Scanlon, we've always been clear about our target as a government, and that was 116,000 full-time equivalents. That was a manifesto commitment. We have always exceeded that target, and that is the philosophy of that, was to move towards full-time, more full-time provision relating to recognised qualifications that would improve the employability prospects.
I appreciate that, Convener, but the previous Cabinet Secretary, Mike Russell, also, you know, and I can understand it. If I'd actually, if 244,000 places had been sacrificed for several thousand additional full-time places, then I think we could accept that. My problem here, and I'm using Spice and Audit Scotland figures, is that we've sacrificed 250,000 places, and we've also had a cut in full-time places. I mean, I don't want to repeat myself, but what we were promised, and I appreciate what you're saying about full-time places, but can I also say that part-time places can lead to people starting up their own businesses, etc. As a previous part-time student myself, I'm aware of the benefits of part-time courses. So I think I'll just leave that one there, Convener. Can I move on to, we were promised that there would be a measurable increase in quality given the college mergers. Can you tell us how the quality of the student experience, the quality of education and training, can you tell us how that is being measured?
Yes, gladly. It is important to also say, before I address that very specific point, that part-time provision is important, and that part-time provision still exists within the sector. Well, we have moved, as I suppose previously explained, we have moved towards full-time provision, and the number of full-time students over the age of 25 and the number of full-time students under the age of 25 and the number of women full-time students has increased. But I did want to stress that we still have part-time provision within our college sector, and you know that it's not an insignificant investment. And with regards to those very short courses, I mean, they still exist, where they have a role to play in terms of access to further education, or indeed have a strong employability component. In terms of Mrs. Scanlon's point with regards to information that gives a good insight to the quality of provision, I referred earlier to the first ever college leaver destinations survey. I think that is a very important piece of information, demonstrating where students head to once they have completed their college course. And as I said, that positive destination figure is at 81.5%. There is also in developing a student satisfaction survey, and there has been a pilot with regards to that survey, and there will be an event later on in the year where the findings of that pilot survey will be shared with the stakeholders, and indeed I'm sure be shared with MSPs. And next year we will, for the first time, or the Funding Council will publish for the first time a student satisfaction survey. There are lots of local surveys in colleges, but I think it's important that there's a student satisfaction survey across the sector, and this will mean that all students will be asked their views. There's other work going on in terms of Education Scotland, which is about supporting colleges to strengthen their ability to self-evaluate and to ensure that they have good quality assurance arrangements in place.
Final question, convener. I'm sure you're very familiar with this document with your friend and colleague, Mr. Salmond, but within the SNP manifesto for 2011 was a promise of national pay bargaining, indeed a promise of a national set of terms and conditions. And I'm sure you understand that in the Highlands and Islands, and I was a lecturer before coming in here, colleagues of mine in that sector are paid up to £7,000 annual salary lower than colleagues elsewhere in Scotland. Now, I think we would all find it unacceptable if teachers, nurses and doctors were paid different salaries in the Highlands and Islands compared to the Central Belt. So what I would like to ask, this morning we heard from the college principals that intensive discussions are taking place. They've been taking place for 5 years now. We need to accelerate the pace, and also that transitional monies are needed. And I wonder if I could point to the cut in funding to colleges from the Scottish Funding Council of £166 million and ask if perhaps some of that money could be allocated towards the pay gap between college lecturers. I do understand that college staff, support staff, I understand that that's now been settled and there is a national set of terms and conditions, so it's just the lecturers. Thank you.
This government remains absolutely committed to national pay bargaining for many of the reasons that Mary Scanlon has outlined. I would say that progress has been made. There was a considerable effort and amount of very detailed work had to go in devising the national rules and procedures. Now, the majority of colleges are signed up to the national rules and procedures and to the principle of pay bargaining. And I'm keen, through my discussions with the sector as a whole, with staff representatives, and the Funding Council, to be pushing that forward. I don't believe we are far away from national pay bargaining, but I think we all have to pick up the pace here and get the agreement in principle that everybody is signed up to that. There are still some issues in terms of the college side. Some of that's not so much about the principle of national pay bargaining. Some of it is perhaps more internal as to how the sector as a whole is represented within Colleges Scotland. I have always been clear that the issue of harmonisation won't be achieved overnight. I've always been crystal clear about that. But national pay bargaining is not unachievable. And, I think we all have to make that final step.
Is the government willing to fund transitional monies? Because obviously the UHI couldn't possibly give every lecturer an extra 7,000. So given the huge pay gap there, is the government in future, or once the agreement has been reached, are they willing to put money into the sector to ensure that we have equal pay?
I mean, we're looking very closely at the detail of that. I mean, I am conscious of the challenges for smaller institutions, some of those smaller institutions that Mrs. Scanlon will be well familiar with. I think it is harder for the very small institutions, and we're very cognizant of that.
A supplementary from James Dolan.
Yes, I'd just like to come back on a couple of points. Just the very last point, Paul Little from City of Glasgow College did say that the national pay bargaining was a process and not an event, and he was very confident that we'd get there reasonably soon, which I think is fairly encouraging. But I'd like to go back to my colleague, Mary Scanlon, who seems to be able to get away with showing SNP brochures here, which is great. If only I could get away with that. But she was talking about the difference between full-time and part-time, but surely the latest data from the Scottish Funding Council, which shows that 95% of teaching hours were delivered in courses leading to a recognised qualification since 2006-07. The number of funded FT students studying recognised qualifications is up almost 2,000. And the number studying HNC and HND qualifications highly prized by employers is up almost 4,000 in 2012-13. It is a positive move and also highlights the fact that the further education, the colleges are doing their bit in making sure that people are ready for work once they leave the colleges.
I mean, there are a number of very important statistics that relate specifically to outcomes. Mr. Dornan is right to say that the number of students achieving HNC / HNDs it has increased by over 22% between 2006-07 and 13-14. Also, crucially, there has been a 34% increase in students that progress from college to university with advanced standing, and that's very important in terms of the widening access agenda. And we shouldn't forget the role that colleges play in providing higher education across the sector. It's nearly 20%, but for colleges like the City of Glasgow, they primarily provide HE provision. In terms of more recognised qualifications being achieved by full-time students, we have nearly 11,000 more students successfully completing full-time courses, whether that's in FE or HE provision. So in terms of outcomes for students, there is much to be pleased with.
Mark.
Thanks, Camilla. I know what the Cabinet Secretary has said in terms of achieving a solution on national pay bargaining and that progress has been made, but if I can just quote from the EIS submission for today's session, they've said, the reform process has singularly failed to make substantive progress in relation to national collective bargaining and equal pay for lecturing staff across the sector. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to respond to the EIS comments that seem to clash with your own on progress being made towards national pay bargaining?
Well, as I say, I mean, I met with EIS fella very recently, as I do, with a range of stakeholders and trade unions. I don't think we are far away from national pay bargaining. As I said earlier to Mary Scanlon, we all, have to be stepping up to the plate on that one. We appreciate that there are some, issues that still have to be resolved. I am really keen that those issues are resolved and that we'll do what I can with the relevant partners. In terms of the harmonisation agenda, I would be very keen to see a roadmap to that. I would be keen to see, the Funding Council, but crucially, the trade unions and Scotland's colleges working together to provide, that roadmap, over a period of time to see, what progress can be made in terms of harmonisation.
I mean, I think we'd all like to see quick progress towards that national pay bargaining, but your own comments seem to contrast with that of the EIS. They've also said that failure is likely to lead directly to industrial action. Would you consider that a failure of government if there is industrial action as a result of a failure to reach an agreement on national pay bargaining?
I mean, I think any industrial action would be regrettable. It's not in the interest of, students or their families. Government, of course, is not the employer. We do have a role in terms of, the glue in the system, and I will, continue to do what I can to support and encourage both the trade union representatives and the employers to be working working together in the interests of their institutions, but fundamentally in the interests of students.
You're right in saying that government is not the employer, but as Mary Scanlon pointed out, it was in a government manifesto to achieve. So I would expect the government to be doing that rather than saying that they're not the employers. The EIS have also said that no other national harmonisation process has been unfunded and have cited the example of the Macron agreement for teachers and the NHS agenda for change. Along the lines of Mary Scanlon's question, will there be any additional funding to bridge the gap? And do you have any comments on, aside from national pay bargaining, the colleges who haven't accomplished terms and harmonisation of terms and conditions within their own individual college structures?
I mean, I think there's a number of things that have to be unravelled. It's important to be clear that the prospect of industrial action is about pay. It's about the 15-16 pay settlement. It's not about national pay bargaining. And as a government, we do indeed remain committed to the principle of national pay bargaining and will do everything that we can to make that a reality. As I've already said, I firmly believe that we are not far away from national pay bargaining. In terms of the pay settlement for this year, of course, the three support unions, as indicated by Mrs. Scanlon, have already settled. But the issue of harmonisation has always been, a longer term one, and one that would never be achieved overnight. But we do need that roadmap as to how we will get there. And it's important, that the roadmap isn't something that I will do in my office in splendid isolation. The roadmap, has to be devised by trade union representatives and representatives of the workforce and the employers, and so that there is buy-in across the sector and from both the workforce and the employers.
Thank you. Liam.
Thank you very much. Can I welcome the fact that James Dorn has confirmed that SNP are going to producing brochures in future rather than manifestos? It sounds a lot more fuzzy and cuddly. Just in relation to the numbers, Mary Scanlon pointed up the drop of around 150,000 in part-time places, but the figures we've had from Scottish Funding Council in terms of full-time equivalent learning also suggest that in terms of the hours of learning, there's been an over 3% drop in those hours for 16 to 24-year-olds, a drop of over 12% for 25-year-olds, and a drop overall of just under 8%. In terms of student union unit of measurement, those have dropped since 2010 from 2,070,000 to just over 1.9 million. So it's even against the benchmark that the Cabinet Secretary has indicated of full-time equivalence being the key measure, we're seeing a drop in numbers. Does that not suggest that the government is failing to deliver what it promised?
No. What I would point to, and I do appreciate that, there's a range of statistics, and a range of measurements that can create quite a complex picture. But when we look at the average hours per student, that has actually risen by 63%. So before our term of office, the average hours of learning per student was 246. The average hours for learning per student is now 401. We know that we have more people under 25, over 25, studying full-time courses. That has been a deliberate policy choice of this government, because more full-time courses, more recognised qualifications, better job prospects. But that does not mean that part-time provision, which is indeed important, it still exists.
We've gone from more learners and more hours against the figures produced by Scottish Founding Council, which show the number of hours by age group are down and the student union of, unit of measurement is also down. But can I turn to the issue in relation to funding? We'll have an opportunity, I think, to cover this a bit this afternoon, but in the evidence in the first session, Annette Bruton suggested that student support and a lack of student support is the main reason for non-completion of courses, and Paul Smart from Glasgow College made a plea that there are real pressures there and more funding is needed. Is that a plea that you're likely to heed?
I mean, I'm very alert to the range of issues within our student support system, and I know that Mr. McArthur and I will be discussing this in detail later on this afternoon. I mean, what I would point to is that student support is at a record level, and there's been a 29% real terms increase under this government's term of office in student support. It's just over £105 million. You know, back in the day, we inherited a student support budget of around £67 million. In terms of the bursary that's paid to young people from low-income families or to people from low-income households, it is the highest bursary anywhere in the UK. We have always looked for ways to continuously to improve the student support offer. It's quite a complex proposition. I would certainly like to see it simplified. So we are putting more money into student support, and when shortfalls occur, we have always met those shortfalls.
Just finally, briefly, in terms of the college merger process itself, one of the arguments your predecessor put in supporting the reform package and why additional funding was not perhaps needed, or certainly not needed to the extent the college sector was suggesting at the time, was that he predicted there would be £50 million of annual savings by 2015-16. Audit Scotland have made clear that that has not materialised. Why do you believe that Mr Russell got it so badly wrong?
I think the Scottish Funding Council have confirmed that those £50 million annually recurring savings will be evident from this financial year onwards.
So they're not apparent for 2015-16, it's just a delay in the arrival of the £50 million?
No, not at all. I mean, I don't think we ever said that, you know, that the savings would be immediate. When you embark upon a reform programme, you know, quite often you have to, you know, invest some money, and there was certainly money invested to make mergers, for example, possible. So I don't think Mr Russell ever made any claims about savings being immediately visible. But as the Funding Council have confirmed, from this coming financial year, those £50 million per year savings will be made.
Well, agree to disagree on that. On you go.
That's very kind of you, Liam. Thank you. John.
Convener, just following on from Liam's question there with regards to student support, we did ask the, you know, the previous people who were in here that the student support, obviously NUS had a concern about that, and the NUS had said that the support was not fit for purpose. So I'm, in a way, relieved, if you like, that you're going to give additional money toward that. Well, two questions is that prior to that, we did know that there was a percentage dropout because of a lack of support. Have you any idea what that number is just now?
I think it goes without saying that for any student, the financial support that they receive is important, whether they're at college or university. And while there will be many reasons that lead to students dropping out, of course, you know, perhaps their personal circumstances, but of course, you know, that their personal finances and the financial, you know, packages that are available, you know, are an important part of, you know, ensuring a student's, you know, continued engagement with their course.
But so can you tell us what the figure is for us?
I mean, I can go away and ask the funding council or individual institutions if they have
track
that
it then
information.
Between, you know, obviously, if you're given a dish.
But we how about you both speak at the same time?
No, of course
not. But just sorry. If yes, don't mind. Sorry, Cameron, I couldn't catch the end of your.
No, I was saying I was quite would be happy to ask the funding council or individual institutions about what type of information they have with regards to the matter that Mr. Pentland raises. But it is important to recognise that the positive destinations of people leaving college is at 81.5%, and we know that completion rates over the term of this government have actually increased as well. So I'm not saying that student finance isn't important and that we need to give it serious consideration, but we are increasing investment and we are seeing completion and retention rates up and good positive destinations as well.
Just one final question. Obviously, you did say that the budget for 15-16 is flatlined and they're not. If you're going to give money to additional student support, where is that money coming from then?
Well, as we do every year, any gap in student support is met from, you know, as met from our resources. And, you know, we have met, you know, redirected resources into student support.
George Adam.
Thank you. You're glad to hear it's just one question, but for me it's probably the most important question. It's the key part of college reform was the developing Scotland's young workforce, and actually focusing on actually how we did vocational training for young people. Now, we heard earlier on about all the great work that's been going on in Glasgow and Edinburgh College since then, and my questions are quite simply, you know, the college sector, historically, they've been doing this. Is it better now? Has the college reform helped with that? Is it more focused? And how can we actually, at this stage, make sure that some of the areas that maybe aren't engaging with business to the extent they should be, how do we help these colleges and make sure that they do deliver on that?
I suppose, as I said in my answer earlier to Mr. Beattie, the college involvement with the Invest in Young People groups is absolutely crucial, as is the engagement between schools and colleges. And that engagement has really went from strength to strength. We started off with two pathfinders for the work that's been done on foundation apprenticeships. We now have several, you know, pathfinders into, you know, the foundation apprenticeships. You know, most local authorities are working with their local colleges on things like foundation apprenticeships. And as I said in my answer to Mr. Beattie, you know, there are 2,500 senior phase pupils across Scotland who are studying courses at college, and there's a wide variety of college courses that are available to young people. So there is a mutual benefit both for college reform and the young workforce agenda. I'm very clear, and it goes back to my days as when I was the Minister for Youth Employment, that I want to see that parity of esteem between vocational education and higher education. And much of that starts in the senior phase in secondary schools. And the real ambition within our senior phase in secondary schools is that we have to move towards a system that is more bespoke for individual young people, where they can choose the right blend. They don't necessarily have to make a choice between pursuing academic, or what's strictly understood as academic subjects, and vocational subjects, that actually they will be able to get the right blend that suits them. So I think the pace of change from year one to year two in terms of the number of senior phase pupils studying courses at college, in terms of the progress that's been made with foundation apprenticeships, is very encouraging. But it's progress that we have to continue with, and we have to continue with that pace of progress.
Liam MacArthur.
I think probably back to the line of questioning that Chip Brody was adopting earlier on in relation to SDS's involvement. I think I'm right in saying that when these proposals first came forward in terms of transferring funding through the College Learning Programme, now the Employability Fund, there was a concern of fragmentation. I think it was at the time described as biscuit tin funding of college places and of training generally. Is there a concern within government that we may have too much segmentation or fragmentation of the funding, that isn't necessarily helping in terms of having a kind of clear view on what's happening in the delivery of training and skills development?
I think you always have to be alert to having clear strategic priorities, and you want to get that balance right between having a range of different types of funding opportunities but not having something that's too fragmented. But I think for me the bigger principle is always looking at outcomes and what, and at our starting point has to be about what does this deliver first and foremost for students.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, thank you. Thank you for coming along this morning and your officials. We're, as usual, grateful for your time, and I'll suspend the meeting briefly. Thank you.
Our next item is to take evidence on two pieces of subordinate legislation as listed on the agenda. Can I welcome Aileen Campbell, Minister for Children and Young People, and her accompanying officials? After we have taken evidence on the instruments, we will debate the motions in the name of the Minister, item 3. Officials, of course, are not permitted to contribute to the formal debates. Before I invite the Minister to make some opening remarks, can I inform the committee that we will consider a petition next week that calls for kinship carers to receive the same allowances as foster carers? The instrument before us today should meet the petitioner's concerns. I certainly hope so. Can I invite the Minister to make some opening remarks on both instruments? Minister.
Thank you, Convener. And you sound as well as I do.
Yeah, I think it's going around, yeah.
Thank you again, Convener, for the opportunity to introduce a variety of instruments arising from the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014. And I'll speak to all of the instruments now, but we'll be happy to take questions on each of them in turn. Firstly, I am introducing the regulations under Part 14 on the Adoption Register of the 2014 Act. Through the 2014 Act, Scotland's Adoption Register has been placed on a statutory footing. The regulations make detailed provision in connection with the operation of the register. The register provides opportunities for children to be matched with families across Scotland if they cannot be matched locally. Scotland's Adoption Register has been operating on a non-statutory basis since 2011, and in that time, the register has facilitated 255 matches with adoptive families. In moving the register onto a statutory footing, adoption agencies will be required to refer children and adopters. We believe this will increase the effectiveness of the register in assisting with the adoption process. The draft regulations make provisions in four main areas. These include the point at which children who ought to be placed for adoption are added to the register, the point at which approved prospective adopters are added to the register, the time frame for adoption agencies to submit this information, and the circumstances where disclosing information from the register can be authorised. The regulations also specify what information the register is to contain and how the register will be kept up to date. We believe that by requiring all adoption agencies to use the register within defined timescales as set out in these draft regs, the delays with some children face in being matched with adoptive families will be reduced. Moving on to the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland Order 2016, arising from Part 13 on support for kinship care of the 2014 Act. Under this part, the Scottish Government has placed the duty on local authorities to make arrangements to secure that kinship care assistance is made available to the following specific categories of eligible people. An adult who is applying for a kinship care order, an adult who is considering applying for a kinship care order, an adult with a kinship care order, a child subject to a kinship care order if the relevant eligibility test is met, and an eligible child who has reached the age of 16 but who were subject to a kinship care order immediately prior to turning 16 years old. This order makes provision in seven main areas, and these are the manner in which a local authority shall provide kinship care assistance, the types of kinship care assistance that local authorities must or may provide to each category of eligible person, an extension of the definition of eligible child, factors that must be considered in assessing whether a child is at risk of being looked after for the purposes of being an eligible child, the procedure that local authorities must follow when notifying a person who has applied for kinship care assistance, and finally, the information that local authorities must publish. We believe this instrument will ensure that additional support is provided that will assist kinship carers, children and young people in kinship care to provide safe and stable long-term care for children who might otherwise require or continue to require formal care. Next, under Parts 4 on the Named Person and 5 on the Child's Plan of the Act, there are two orders to be introduced. The modification of Schedules 2 and 3 order relates to the provisions of information and assistance to named person services, providers and to organisations exercising functions in relation to the Child's Plan. The order will add the principal reporter to Schedules 2 and 3, ensuring that they are subject to the duties of a relevant authority specified in Part 4 of the Act, and the duties of a listed authority as specified in Part 5 of the Act. The effect of these additions is that the principal reporter will be required in appropriate circumstances to provide information and assistance to named person service provision providers under Part 4 and to organisations exercising Child's Plan functions under Part 5. The principal reporter will also receive information from a named person service provider in respect of a child or young person, where that is likely to be relevant to the principal reporter's function as regard that child or young person's well-being. Further discussion with the relevant bodies have made clear that schedules 2 and 3 needed to be revised from the existing wording of, in the 2014 Act, which does not include the principal reporter in the list of persons specified as relevant and listed authorities. And we have had discussions with the principal reporter, who is content to be added. Turning to part 4 and 5, complaints order. This order covers complaints about the exercise of functions set out in parts 4 and 5, that is the name person and the child's plan, and it sets out procedures for resolution of such complaints at a local level, and in complementing existing complaints procedures allows for escalation to the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman in a consistent manner across Scotland. Specifically, the order will cover the following matters: clarification around what may be the subject of a complaint, who can make a complaint, how the complaint should be made, timescales for the different stages of the complaints procedure, who should consider the complaint and how the complaint should be considered and investigated, how information can be obtained to support any investigation, and finally, what should be included in the determination of a complaint. Details of an improved complaint system in relation to the Ombudsman's remit are also specified. Under Article 9 of the Order, those matters that can be subject to complaints under the Order can be investigated by the Ombudsman, who will now have the power to investigate the merits of a decision taken in exercise of a function conferred under these parts of the 2014 Act. As part of the development of the complaints procedure, we will be developing and consulting on guidance in the coming months, with publication set for early June. And we've worked closely with the stakeholders in the development of the Order, not least the Ombudsman. I know that the Ombudsman has written to the Convener about the Order, and it's gratifying that Jim Martin acknowledges the level of cooperation with his office and his support for an approach to complaints based on the SPSO's own existing models. And we note that he has some reservations about the level of detail about the complaints process in the Order. However, as Mr Martin acknowledges and as the Committee knows, the relevant sections of the 2014 Act already set out what is required of the complaints process in some detail. And it is for Ministers to specify this process by order, which is to be subject to parliamentary scrutiny. If we had not provided such explicit detail in the draft order, but had sought to leave this detail to guidance or to a procedure set out by someone else, then we would not have been meeting the intentions of Parliament when it agreed unanimously to these sections, or indeed the wider public's expectations that a robust but flexible complaints process will be put in place for such an important policy area. So, thank you, Convener, for allowing me to make some opening remarks on all of the orders that we're laying today, and I look forward to taking the committee's questions on the first of those.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Minister. I intend, just for committee's benefit, I intend to allow members to ask questions on the kinship care orders first, and then we'll move to the vote on that, and then we'll ask questions on the named person complaints order, and then move to the vote on that. So we'll deal with the kinship care area first, if you don't mind, Minister. Do members have any questions on the in relation to the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland order? Liam.
Are we talking about the adoption register as well?
So, adoption and kinship first, and then we'll deal with the named person.
It was less a question, Convener, it was just an acknowledgement of the reference in the briefing provided that there appears to be a recognition of the need to work very collaboratively north and south of the border in order, I think, to maximise the opportunities for making those matches between adopters, prospective adopters and children. So it was really, I think, to acknowledge that and welcome it, to be honest.
Okay. Thank you. Chickbury.
Good afternoon. I wonder if I may ask about just for clarification, the revolving door principle. If one agency says that a person can be a prospective adopter and then subsequently find that they are not acceptable, then that person can then move on to another agency who can then presumably re-register them. I mean, what built-in check is there in terms of making sure that the register reflects the bona fide information regarding prospective adoption? That's the first question. Second question, I sympathise with how you feel. The second question is the security of the data generally, in terms of whether it be about the child or a prospective adopter, if we have this possibility or practicality of moving on and off the register. I mean, how is that information is secure? What are the penalties if somebody, what are the proposed penalties if somebody doesn't abide by the regulation?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Brosey, for the questions there. And you know, in relation to the first question there about the checks, I mean, this is something that has to be a dynamic piece of kit that allows us to refresh and you know, make amendments to who should be on and off. There isn't any evidence that what you describe is a factor. We'll make sure that there are strict parameters in place to protect children. As is always the case, though, these things are always robust, and this is also something that has been in place informally since 2011, and the issue that you describe hasn't been an issue or hasn't been a factor that's been raised. In terms of the security and robustness of the system, the software, again, has been in place since 2011, is also used by the registers for England and Wales, and it's been subject to penetration testing, and the security of any future amendment to the system will be subject to the same rigorous test. So access to the data is confined to two members of staff and to those agency staff directly involved in linking a specific child and family for adoption. So the systems that we have in place are fairly robust and fairly well tested, and has we have confidence that this will remain and be the case as it moves forward, and has already been in use across other parts of the UK.
Thank you. Mary Scanlon.
Nearly have policy that I'm very familiar with, but I wonder if I can just seek some clarity. Like Liam MacArthur, I was delighted to see that information contained in the register in Scotland will also appear on adoption registers for England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Can I ask if the reverse is also true, that you know, information in England, Wales and Northern Ireland appears in Scotland? And can I just ask a second question? It all sounds highly positive. The figures you gave for matches, 255, didn't seem to be very high. Would your expectations be that these matches could be increased given the implementation of this instrument?
Okay, thank you. In response to the first question you raised, yes, that information can go both ways. And also, yes, it does.
It does, okay.
And also, that figure of 255 should be seen within the context of the children that are on this register being harder to place children. So actually, this is about making sure that we are giving those children the best possible chance of finding a match and finding a nurturing and loving home. So while it may seem a low figure when you're saying it in a, you know, in my own remarks, in which it's not within the context of the numbers, and actually that the fact that these kids are a bit harder to place, and this gives them and offers them the best chance. So it's about matching and increasing that opportunity for young people.
So you would expect an increase in numbers given this instrument?
I would hope that this enables more children to get more places and to get those harder to reach and harder to place children the home that they deserve.
Okay. Any members got any other questions on the adoption register regulations? No. Well, can I, Minister, you know, I've got a couple of questions for myself on the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland order. Can you confirm that the figures with regard to who will be eligible to receive support, what kind of numbers? Is it those who effectively who have formal kinship care orders?
Numbers of what? Numbers of people who we anticipate?
Well, I mean, during the passage of the Children and Young People Bill, the government said there were 3,917 children living in formal kinship care. However, the Scottish Kinship Care Alliance say there are many thousands more who are in formal kinship care relationships in place. Mm-hmm. And I'm just trying to establish that what this is doing is to do with those who are in the formal situation rather than the informal. Is that correct?
Yeah, this is for informal. It allows those people who are in informal kinship care settings to get...
Who are informal?
Sorry.
Rather than informal.
out with formal kinship care arrangements to access the support that they require, because that's where the difficulty has been, that there have been children placed in an informal sense but haven't necessarily always had access to the support that they need, even though some of the needs of those children are the same regardless. But it's also about avoiding those children to end up in the looked after system where outcomes are poorer, and it's to try and act in that preventative way, which is the hallmark of the children's.
So it's those children who are in an informal kinship care situation.
And the eligibility is broad as well, that there is, if there is a risk of that child becoming looked after, then that could be a way in which the family can access the kinship care order too.
Okay.
It's based on the needs of the child as well. It's about trying to be as enabling as possible to allow the local authorities to determine whether or not that child on its needs requires that, and that family requires that support for the needs of that child. So that's why there has been that kind of broadness and
no, that's very,
eligibility.
Very helpful, thank you. My second question is in relation to, I just want to know how the order interacts with the benefit system effectively. Will these allowances be disregarded as income by the benefits system?
We are in discussions with the DWP. The difference with the informal kinship care is that they can be eligible, they can access benefits in a far easier way. So this is about us making sure that we have that as clear as we possibly can for those families who are on the margins and who require a seamless way in which they can access the support that they need. So we are in discussions with the DWP currently to make sure that that's the case.
Are you hopeful of a successful conclusion to those discussions?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other questions on the kinship area? Thank you. As indicated, we now move to the formal debate on the Scotland's Adoption Register Regulations 2016 draft and the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland Order 2016 draft, which is item 3. Can I invite the Minister to speak to and move the motions?
Formally moved.
Thank you very much. Minister, any contributions from members? Okay, thank you. Can I therefore put the question that motion S4M1562 that the Education and Culture Committee recommends that the Scotland's Adoption Register Regulations 2016 draft be approved, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. The second question is that motion S4M15454, that the Education and Culture Committee recommends that the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland Order 2016 draft be approved, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
That's also agreed. Thank you very much. Can I suspend the meeting briefly to allow the is there a change of panel coming? Yeah, I think there is, yes. I'll suspend briefly, yeah. Our next item is to take evidence on two further pieces of subordinate legislation as listed on the agenda. Can I welcome back Aileen Campbell, Minister for Children and Young People, and our accompanying officials. After we have taken evidence on the instruments, we will debate the motions in the name of the Minister. Item 5, again, officials are not permitted to contribute to the formal debate. Minister, I think you've covered these instruments in your previous remarks. Indeed, yeah, okay. Do members have any questions here on this? Mary?
Yes. I wasn't on the committee when the Children and Young People Bill went through. It was my colleague Liz Smith. But I think at the time of the passing, I think Liz Smith did raise some concerns with regard to the implementation of this particular part of the bill. I think my real concern is that, convener, we cannot ignore the concerns of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. And can I just say, the first piece of subordinate legislation is implemented in 30 days. This piece of legislation that we're looking at is implemented in August. So it seems to me that we've got a six-month window of opportunity that I would hope could be used to bring forward changes and to adapt to the concerns of the Ombudsman. I'm sure the Minister is familiar with the Ombudsman's concerns, but he does ask that a simpler approach be adopted, and the approach that's currently being used to modernise social work complaints. He also says that if this goes through, I think from previous experience, in order to bring a change through Parliament, it can take up to 8 years. So obviously better to try and do that within the next 6 months. If I can just read rather than me second-guessing his words, I feel it would be remiss of me not to note that this particular legislative approach of creating the detail of complaints process through regulations is now out of line with other areas. So he's suggesting his support for the government's aim of aligning complaints with the model CHP in operation across the public sector. So what I'm asking, convener, is that the minister take into account the concerns raised in the Ombudsman's letter to the convener of the 23rd of February, and that given that we have 6 months to implementation, that doesn't seem to be an unreasonable request. I also think, given that he's suggesting bringing it in line with other procedures already out there, seems to be a very sensible approach. So I'm asking, convener, if this can be delayed, if we can have a look at it again and use the time prior to implementation to take on board what appears to be the very reasonable request by the Ombudsman, who I think has got more experience of a complaints procedure than anyone around this table. Thank you,
Mary. Minister.
We have been working closely with the SPSO since the passage of the Act in 2014, where all parties agreed to the amendments that I moved, which set out that this would be for ministers to set out the regulation. Now, again, you know, we have been working hard to make sure that there is an alignment there with current and existing policies of complaint. However, this one does start from a different place given the amendments that were passed and agreed to by everyone in 2014. So it is important to note that the Children and Young People Act place duties and the responsibilities on Scottish ministers to develop and implement a complaints procedure for parts 4 and 5 and set out the issues that we might want to take forward in secondary legislation. And that is what I said, and that is what I bring today, and is what I have done. We have, as I say, worked hard with the SPSO. We've taken on board the concerns and issues that have been raised and tried to make sure that what we have within the regulation that we're setting before you is in alignment with other complaints procedures and puts in place something that is clear, transparent and allows families to access the redress if they need to. So I would urge the committee to not delay in taking forward this piece of regulation and be cognisant of the fact that even though there is 6 months, that actually within the parliamentary timetable that would put some pressure on meeting our August deadline.
Thank you. Liam MacArthur.
It's very much on the same point, convener. I think the Minister quite fairly reminds us that this was the collective will of Parliament in passing the Act. In fact, it may be I've been remiss of the Ombudsman not to highlight at that stage concerns about the process that's been adopted. But nevertheless, I think we're being presented with a suggestion that the complaints process being put through in terms of regulations is, as Mary Scanlon says, out of line with other areas in the public sector. And while 6 months is not an enormous amount of time, it may be prudent of the committee to at least allow some of that time to be used to establish whether or not there is a way of bringing complaints processes in this regard in line with practice. I mean, it may well be that that adhering to the views expressed through the original Act remains the desired outcome. But actually, it does seem to me that the Ombudsman is making a fair and reasonable point, and that with the time available, we're as well exploring that in a little more detail.
Do you want anything to add, Minister?
My concern would be that if we change that as per the Ombudsman's suggestion, and bear in mind that what we have put before you today is to be as reflective as we possibly can be of existing complaints processes and procedures and routes. That if we were to go down the route that you're suggesting, that we potentially will have to change the Act that we passed, which actually put the onus on Scottish ministers to come forward with the regulation and the parameters by which somebody could take a complaint. So I would hesitate to say that that would be something that would be desirable, and actually in actual direct contrast, urge you to go and consider that we do pass the regulation today, because it would put in jeopardy the existing starting date for August. And bear in mind that we have, you know, if alignment is the issue, and given in the SPSO's recent media statement, which says that this is a technical minor fault concern, then what we have is what we have is something that is in alignment with other in existing regulation complaints procedures. So we think we've mitigated the concerns that he has raised.
I think the Minister has been perfectly reasonable. I think the Ombudsman has been perfectly reasonable. I mean, obviously, there are concerns about the volume of legislation that passes through secondary legislation, but we have an opportunity here, I think, both in terms of the six-month period before implementation, but actually also in terms of the committee meetings we have before we rise for PIRDA, an opportunity to come back to this. Would it be reasonable of the committee to request further discussion between the Ombudsman and the Scottish Government, and for us to reconsider this at one of our later meetings later this month?
Sorry, no, just hold on 1 second. Mr. MacArthur, must be.
I'm simply asking whether or not we have an opportunity before the end of this session to come back to this and pass it. And as I say, I don't think the Minister has been unreasonable in what she's suggesting. If having passed the Act, actually it transpires that the Ombudsman may be correcting what he's saying, but this needed to be brought to us in evidence during the passage of the bill, in which case we just proceed as proposed by the Scottish Government. But if there is an opportunity to align this better with, as I say, other areas of complaint process in the public sector, it would seem remiss of us not to at least explore that.
It is aligned. It's been developed and designed to be aligned with existing complaints procedures. Well, again, you know, if the substantive issue is that this isn't aligned, well, what we have endeavoured to do is to make sure that this is aligned with existing complaints procedures and has been developed in collaboration and in conversation and dialogue with the SPSO. If that's the substantive issue, then I'm given, I hope, some reassurance that actually what we have in place is something that is transparent, flexible. We'll have the potential to have the scrutiny of the Parliament, but is fulfilling what I set out in the amendments I passed during the passage of the Act, which was supported by everyone in the Parliament, and is a part of the important part of the named person procedure, in that we give families access to a complaints process should they need to take it.
Mr. Donnan, did you want to? Sorry, just covered that. Okay, Mary.
Can I just say, I'm not asking for a delay. I mean, quite often we get these legislation and it's already through, and quite often we get about, 30 days, and that's fine. But in this case, convener, we actually have 6 months. It's not due to be implemented until the 31st of August. So can I put on the record that I am not asking for a delay? I'm asking that the 6 months be used in order to, to have discussions with the Ombudsman. And can I just say, convener, I have a difficulty because I'm no expert on complaints resolution. I'm not sure any of us are. But we have the Minister saying that it's in line with other complaints resolution across the public sector. And I quote from the Ombudsman's letter to you, is now out of line with other areas. So I think where we have such a significant difference in opinion and interpretation or whatever, I just can't put my hand on heart and put this through today. So all I'm asking, convener, is that the 6 months be used in order that reasonable negotiations and understanding are taken forward to make sure that this is right and fit for purpose on the day it's implemented.
Minister, I mean, it is a matter for the government, of course, to decide whether or not they wish to take this away and revise it and bring it back. But that, you know, and it's a matter for the government, Minister.
And again, I just reiterate that we have developed this that to be in alignment with existing procedures there, so that it does have that, avoids that duplication, avoids that unnecessary messiness that I think we all want to avoid. But the fact is, the Act and the amendments that we moved during the passage of the Act is what is driving this as well, and drives it in a slightly different way to other areas of complaint, such as the social work complaints procedures that others have mentioned. So again, regardless if we passed it now or 3 months down the line, the issue is what the Act and what we agreed as a Parliament to take forward, and this is what we have developed to be in line with other existing complaints procedures to allow and offer families the opportunity to take forward complaints should they need to, and delivers them that transparency, the commitment that I gave and the commitment that we all wanted and we all shared to ensure that we're delivering for families in this area of policy.
Okay. Any other further questions on this one? Members? No, okay, I've got a couple. Minister, during the scrutiny of the Children and Young People Bill, the committee corresponded with a member of the public who raised concerns based on her own experience about the information sharing provisions. Now, specifically, she wanted to ensure that information shared about a child must be relevant, proportionate and in line with the principles of the Data Protection Act. She also suggested that, in her experience, teachers and healthcare professionals were not properly trained on the DPA, and that there was a tendency to share everything without checking or asking whether it's relevant. She also suggested that professionals don't think to inform parents before sharing information about their child. In light of that correspondence that the committee has received, can I ask you, will disputes about disproportionate sharing of information or sharing of irrelevant information fall within the scope of making a complaint?
Yes, the information sharing will be part of the complaints procedure.
Okay. Can I also ask you then, how will you ensure that decision makers are properly trained, given the comments I've just made, to make the correct judgments about what information to share? And would you expect specific guidelines to be established at organisation level on the types of information that should be shared?
The part of the Act, and I remember when we went through the process of passing the bill, was around making sure that the workforce who will be required to be named person are trained and properly trained in how to share information appropriately. And also, the complaint that's raised within that letter, the legislation that we passed 2 years ago provides a robust framework to ensure that information is shared in the most appropriate and proportionate way, avoiding that unnecessary scattergun approach that has unfortunately happened in the past. This bill strengthens, and the complaints procedure will allow, if people feel that there has been a breach, that they will be able to take forward, notwithstanding their existing local complaints procedures, that they can go through before they get to this stage.
Final question, the Minister. Given the concerns that have been expressed in this piece of correspondence, and I'm sure it's shared by at least some other parents, do you agree it's important to inform parents before information is shared about their child, and what more can be done to ensure that that actually happens? Now, I do recognise that in some circumstances, of course, that may not be appropriate in particular difficult situations, but with that.
Yeah, absolutely. And the bill and the Act that we passed cites that parents and families should be part of the decision-making process, and guidance will ensure that the best practice, which is always to work with families about information sharing, is followed. So within the guidance, within the Act, we are providing rigour to ensure that families are very much fully involved with any information that requires to be shared.
Okay, thank you very much. If we move on, as indicated, we now move to the formal debate on the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, Part 4 and Part 5 Complaints Order 2016 draft, and the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, Modification of Schedules 2 and 3, Order 2016 draft, which is Item 5. Can I invite the Minister to speak to and move the motions?
Formally moved.
Thank you. Any contributions from members at this stage? Okay. Therefore, I put the question that motion S4M15464, that the Education and Culture Committee recommends that the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, Part 4,
and Part 5 Complaints Order 2016 draft be approved, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We're not all agreed, therefore there will be a division. Therefore, can I ask, with those wishing to support the order, please indicate now. Okay, thank you. Those against? Abstentions? The result on the division on the Part 4, Part 5 Complaints Order, that the order is agreed to. There were seven votes for, no votes against, and one abstention. So S4M 15464 is agreed to. Can I therefore put the question that motion S4M 15456, that the Education and Culture Committee recommends that the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 modifications of Schedules 2 and 3, Order 2016 draft, be approved, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Thank you very much. Can I suspend the meeting briefly to allow the Minister to leave the table? The final item is to consider five pieces of subordinate legislation as listed on the agenda. Do members have any comments on the instruments?
Not at all.
No, thank you very much. Therefore, I know it's only a couple of weeks left, colleagues, but let's just finish this one. Does the committee agree to make no recommendation to the Parliament on the instruments? That's agreed. Thank you very much. Therefore, I close the meeting.